aerial view of downtown Jacksonville, Florida, the St. John's River, as we pan over to Alltel Stadium, where the Toyota Gator Bowl is about to unfold, matching Maryland and West Virginia. Let's go to the sideline, where Maryland coach Ralph Friedgen has joined Lewis Johnson.
All right, John, thanks so much. Well, coach, you won 9 of your last 10 games, and then the season comes to an absolute stop. How have you managed 5 weeks off and getting this team back up for this New Year's Day Bowl?
Well, we only practiced 12 times. We had to let them off for exams so they could do well there. But we've lifted and ran, and I think we're ready to play. Hopefully so, anyway.
Biggest key to beating West Virginia today?
I think being emotionally ready to play them, because they'll be very emotionally ready to play us.
As I can tell you are, too. Happy New Year's and good luck, coach.
Thank you very much.
All right, Tom.
All right, Lewis. West Virginia, Coach Rich Rodriguez. We'll see his team on defense to start the game. West Virginia won the toss. They deferred to the second half, so Maryland will get the ball first. Brad Cooper set to kick off for the Mountaineers. And deep, Steve Suter for the Terrapins, the dangerous one. Cooper's kick into the end zone. Suter will bring it out from halfway in the end zone. Tripped up shy of the 20-yard line, where the Terrapins will begin on offense. There's Scott McBrien, the senior quarterback. 220 yards passing in the September 20th blowout win against the Mountaineers. Yeah, easy wins for Maryland both meetings last year and this season.
Yeah, they scored the first 34 points in that game.
Finished up 34-7. You see the offensive line.
That's a good one.
Veteran units.
Yep. Very good offensive line.
Keep your eye on Bruce Perry. Beset by injuries, but he is averaging over 5 yards a carry this season and is a terrific running back when he's healthy. They're in the I formation. Perry is the tailback. Here's the gift to him. Dancing forward. And he gets about 4 yards on first down. And a look at the West Virginia defense beginning the games. Adam Pac-Man Jones made that stop from the secondary up front. Hunter Lynch and Hardy with Yurko, Wiley, Leonard, and Lorello. Wiley is the man to watch, the All-American linebacker. King, Washington, Jones, who made that tackle, and Frazier. Second down. McBrien again to Perry. And Bruce Perry tackled after another short gain as a little skirmish breaks out. These are big rivals. Arello made the tackle for the Mountaineers.
First skirmish of 2004 for us, Tom.
You know, no, how about the one coming over here?
Yeah, you and I. Yeah, yeah. You know, we talked about Ralph Friedgen's offense and what kind of balance they are. Look, 195 yards rushing, 217 passing. This, and I mentioned it when you're doing the lineup, I think the offensive line for Maryland is one of the best offensive lines in college football. You can only have balance and protect your quarterback, you know, only 19 sacks on the year, if you have a really good offensive line, and the Terrapins indeed do.
McBrien from the shotgun with a pitch, and Perry will have the first down. Bruce Perry, as they operate from the spread, three wide receiver formation, and from the shotgun, McBrien pitching to Perry for the first down.
You know, I've been watching Ralph Friedgen's teams for years and years, Tom, and in offense, they are so multiple. You know, saw two off-tackle runs, then a little pitch here to Perry to get to the outside. So two inside plays, and then one outside. You'll see play action, you'll see rollout, and you'll see all the receivers involved, including the tight ends and backs, in the receiving game.
Perry had that 237-yard rushing game against Wake Forest earlier this year. McBrien's first pass on target to Suter for a big first down gain. Lance Frazier forces him out of bounds, but Steve Suter, good for 17 yards, his 26th reception of the season.
You know, you always have to respect Steve Suter's speed. You see the 15.5-yard average. Actually, over the last 2 years, Steve Suter has averaged 15 yards per touch on catches like this, on returns, and they use him in the running game too, on reverses and things. So this is a guy who is an absolute deep ball threat in a variety of ways.
All ACC performer. Three wide receiver formation, eye in the backfield. Perry's the tailback, Fiddler the fullback. First down play, Maryland on the opening drive of the game. Give to Perry. Dancing in the scrimmage, breaking free into the outside. And Perry has another big gain as the Terrapins get 9 yards on first down. Brian King, the free safety, makes the tackle.
Bruce Perry, he's running like Bruce Almighty here. I mean, he sees the field well, he cuts well, as you see there, and then he accelerates. Another cut. So good vision, two cuts, and acceleration all in the one run by Bruce Perry. He was, I think you mentioned, the ACC Player of the Year as a sophomore. Been battling injuries the last 2 years. Missed 11 games because of injuries. Boy, when he is healthy, he is something very fun to watch.
And he told us he was healthy, and judging from that last cut, I believe he is.
The last two cuts.
They are close enough to demand a measurement here. After the first down run, got about 9 yards, as we said. And so it'll be second and short for Ralph Friedgen, who has brought this Maryland program into prominence. The 56-year-old Maryland grad, who has been Coach of the Year, back at his alma mater, and taking the Terrapins to perhaps a 10-win season again if they can win this game and in their third bowl in a row.
You know, 30-8 in his first 3 years. I mean, there's very, very few teams that have won 10 games three successive years. If Maryland were to win today, they'd be among the elite teams in the country that have been able to win 10 games 3 years in a row.
Perry, 4 yards, 4 yards, 4 yards, and then that run of nine, making it second and one.
Wind is average.
Stopped short that time as the West Virginia defense stacked it up in the middle.
I tell you, one thing that West Virginia is going to have to do much better than they did in the first game, and Jeff Castile, the defensive coordinator for West Virginia, talked to us about it a week ago, was, hey, you know, we just have to stop the run a lot better. That 260 yards Maryland ran against West Virginia in that first game. Jeff Castile, the defensive coordinator, said if we could just slow down that run, we have a chance of being a lot more competitive than we were in that first game.
Adam Leonard, who is the second leading tackler for the Mountaineers behind Grant Wiley, made that stop. So it sets up a third and one. Perry behind the fullback, Fiddler. Power formation. Yes. The West Virginia player jumped. Was he drawn off or is that a freebie? It was Lynch, the nose tackle, who came across early. He's a good one. 6'4", 265, a junior from Oil City, Pennsylvania.
Number Tom Beard.
Yeah, dead ball foul. Offside. It's a defense. It's a play made contact in the neutral zone. 5-yard penalty. The penalty yardage is enough for a first down.
Smith, the center, right here. Sometimes he didn't actually squeeze his hand. Sometimes centers will actually squeeze their hand a little early on third and short to get guys to jump. But Ben Lynch just guessed on the snap count, offside for the first down for the Terrapins. That's a good matchup, Smith and Lynch.
If I'm not mistaken, you weren't supposed to give that away. From the shotgun on first down, play action fake. McBrien whips it left-handed. He's got his man inside the 10-yard line. JoJo Walker.
JoJo Walker has really come on for Ralph Friedgen in the second half of the year. In the first game, he dropped three balls against West Virginia in the first quarter. But since then, he has really come on. Right here in the slot, gets right behind in that little soft spot behind the linebackers in front of the corner, Lance Frazier, a drill shot by Scott McBrien.
Boy, he had that one, didn't he? Right on a rope.
Yeah, perfect throw. And again, you see what makes him so difficult to defend. They run, 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 power, finesse run, and then they throw the ball downfield.
Gain of 29, first and goal. Bruce Perry tripped up at the line of scrimmage and tackled solidly that time by Leonard, who was first to hit him.
You know, Kyle,
and Adam Jones got a piece too. Sorry, Pat.
Excuse me, Tom. You know, Terrapins been awfully good inside the opponent's 20-yard line in their red zone area. But Kyle Smith, the center, that matchup between him and Ben Lynch, the nose tackle of West Virginia, is going to be one we're going to be watching all day. Smith's had a great year at center, and Ben Lynch on the other side has been great every game for West Virginia, right inside there.
And they've scored all but twice inside the red zone, as you saw. Option play. McBrien still has it and tackled for a loss back at the 10-yard line. West Virginia ready for the option that time. Unable to get the corner. McBrien had no one to pitch to. A little words being passed back and forth as West Virginia with Lawrence Audina coming up quickly made the stop.
Yeah, but you see, it's just so hard. I mean, you power, you option, the play action, you throw the ball downfield. You always seem to be on your heels against Ralph Friedgen's teams.
Third and goal from the 10. McBrien in the shotgun. Now he'll point out something as they get the blocking assignments. formation correctly, sends the man in motion and takes the snap. McBrien looking to the end zone and will throw it out of the end zone, way over the head of his intended receiver, Walker. And it'll be fourth down and a field goal attempt for Friesian and the Terps.
Yeah, smart throw by Scott McBrien and terrific coverage by the Mountaineers. And Brian King, the free safety, the former roommate of Scott McBrien when they were at West Virginia together, good coverage on JoJo Walker.
And so Nick Novak will attempt a field goal, the all-time leading score in Maryland football history and fourth all-time in the Atlantic Coast Conference. West Virginia had a mix-up of personnel, apparently, and they're calling a timeout. So West Virginia calls a timeout.
You can always tell the defensive coordinators.
That's a look at Jeff Castile. And so Maryland will attempt a field goal, we assume, when we return to the Gator Bowl. First drive of the game underway, Maryland threatening. Oh, first drive of the game. Maryland has had it for 10 plays, 71 yards with a 26-yard field goal attempt upcoming from their kicker, Nick Novak. John Kondo, the snapper. And the holder is Adam Podlesch, the punter.
Novak's had a terrific career kicking, 62 career field goals.
And you can make it 63 as Novak, the all-time leading scorer at Maryland, all-ACC performer, makes his 23rd field goal of this campaign. And Ralph Friedgen and the Terrapins break on top 3-0, taking the opening kickoff and marching down for the go-ahead field goal.
You know, you always worry about that first drive, Tom, after a five-week layoff, you know. But that was a very efficient drive. You saw a little bit of everything from his offense, Charlie Taft, the offensive coordinator, and that was a well-called and well-executed first drive by the Terrapins.
And we invite you to log on to NBCSports.com for in-depth coverage of college football's bowl season. Plus, email us your thoughts on the hottest topics like the BCS and perhaps a split national championship. That's all at NBCSports.com. Playoff, Pat, playoff.
I've been saying it for 15 years. No reason you can't do it. No reason you can't do it with the existing bowl system. Play 10 or 11 regular season games. You don't have to have a longer season.
So Novak is teeing it up for the Terrapins, who have taken a field goal on their opening drive of the game. And West Virginia about to touch the ball for the first time on offense.
And the old Pac-Man Jones, you mentioned him earlier. He's already returned a kickoff for a touchdown this year. Dynamic returner.
And Novak's kick. It'll be Pac-Man into the end zone and out with it. And slipped and fell at about the 15-yard line. So poor field position for the Mountaineers on offense for the first time. And a look at Rasheed Marshall, who had not a very effective game in that loss to Maryland in September.
Only 25 yards passing. And, you know, he said to us yesterday when we talked to Rasheed, it's all on me. I've got to play better, and I've got to run the ball better.
Rasheed, a very soft-spoken young man.
Nice young man.
Be behind Watson, Moses, Hines, Burke, and Justice. It's been scrambled around a bit during the season, much more effective than earlier. And keep your eye on number three, Quincy Wilson, over 1,300 yards rushing this season. There is Wilson with his first carry. Pounding out a short game, maybe 3 yards. And this Maryland defense, which ranks 12th in college football in scoring defense, allowing just 16 points a game. Eli Feldheim and Starks. Starks, an all-ACC performer. Cochran, Jackson, Joe, and Ambush. You gotta love that name for a linebacker. And every member of this secondary made one of the all-ACC teams. Very tough secondary. Marshall's first pass is complete, short of the first down. Pass was caught by Henderson. And tackled immediately by Dominique Foxworth.
You know, you mentioned that Maryland defensive secondary. Well, the whole defense has played very well for Gary Blackney, the defensive coordinator. There's Jerome Cox, one of them. See what they ranked in the ACC first in four different categories. The most important, of course, is that scoring defense. Number one scoring defense. They're very, very tough. Rich Rodriguez said, by far the best defense we've played all year.
They held West Virginia to 156 yards in that first meeting. So third down and a yard for West Virginia. Marshall still with the ball. Fires it incomplete. Wide of Henderson, his intended receiver.
I tell you, Rasheed Marshall wanted to run that, Tom, but I think Leon Joe, number 32 for Maryland, really prevented that. I think Rasheed Marshall had run in his mind first. A third and short, he thought, maybe I can outrun Leon Joe. No way. And has to get rid of it and not accurate. So that's a really good play by Joe.
Marshall telling us that it was going to be up to him to make some plays running with the ball. Unable to do so there. The Mountaineers will punt. Todd James, their senior punter from New Eagle, Pennsylvania, averaging over 40 yards per kick.
You know, he has what they call a second timeout on a special teams play. So they've wasted, maybe not wasted, but they've used two timeouts on special teams plays. One on the field goal block and one on a punt.
So a little rust showing with a long layoff of the Mountaineers, unable to get the proper personnel on the field. It was Kevin McGlee earlier that failed to get out for field goal defense. Now they take another timeout to get the formation straight. Made a big defensive play for the Terrapins, preventing a run by quarterback Rasheed Marshall, setting up this punt. Suter awaits the punt by Todd James.
Suter had 5 punt returns for touchdowns in his career.
James boots it on its way. Low.
Didn't see it.
But good bounce. And Suter picks it up on the bounce. Shakes one tackler, but not the second. And driven down at about the 37-yard line. 47-yard punt, 7 yards on the return. Brent Wiley made the special teams tackle. Well, we mentioned that one of the big storylines of the game was Maryland quarterback Scott McBrien, who began his career at West Virginia. He saw his most significant playing time in 2000 as a West Virginia quarterback against Notre Dame. Threw for 252 yards and a TD against the Irish, but West Virginia lost the game 42-28. And because he wanted to start, McBrien transferred to Maryland, where he has beaten his former team twice. He said no hard feelings. He just wanted the opportunity to play. And Coach Rich Rodriguez of West Virginia said, we didn't want him to leave. Play action fake. McBrien still has it. The lefty rolling to his right. Unable to pass, keeps it and dives forward across the 40-yard line.
Yeah, you were right about Rich Rodriguez. He said, you know, we certainly didn't want Scott McBrien to transfer. We felt he could play for us. But, you know, he's caught in one of those battles. There were 3 quarterbacks there, Brad Lewis, Rasheed Marshall, and himself. And as a lot of quarterbacks do in college football, felt his best chance to start was to transfer. And it's worked out very well for Scott, and it's obviously worked out well for West Virginia. And Rasheed Marshall's had a very solid year for the Mountaineers.
And on that last play, he was tackled by his former roommate at West Virginia, Brian King. Fake to Perry. No, give it to Bruce Perry. Kept his balance and is close to the first down right at that yellow line.
Bruce Perry breaks a lot of tackles, but you know he doesn't get hit much early in the runs because it's Stephon Heyer, the left tackle, the left guard here. C.J. Brooks doing a good job. Kyle Smith, the center. We talked about this offensive line. Only 19 sacks, and they've been able to run for 23 touchdowns, pass for 17 touchdowns, and very, very balanced. Almost equal run and passing yards for the Terrapins.
Injured West Virginia player, it's Lawrence Audina. You may have seen at the end of that play, Perry sort of diving or lost his balance, and his helmet hit Audina on the knee or on the leg. Let's see
number
if you can figure it out.
Yeah, right there, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, man, right on his left knee. You know, more and more guys aren't wearing knee pads anymore. You know, you see a lot of guys wearing no knee pads or thigh pads. It's kind of shots you try to avoid.
Audina, the junior from Norwalk, has an interception this season.
He made a really good stop down in the goal line earlier in the game, too.
Did on the option.
Yep.
To high school at Milford Academy, an All-State fullback and linebacker there. In fact, rushed for over 1,000 yards. Looks like he's okay as he walked to the sideline. Replaced by Leandre Washington. Third down and a yard, just short of a yard. And McBrien sneaks and apparently has enough for the Maryland first down.
You know, it ran right behind Kyle Smith, the center. We talked about him a little bit. Ben Lynch playing for Rich Rodriguez at nose tackle. A really good matchup today. You don't oftentimes talk about centers and nose tackle, but we have some good tail of tape. See Ben Lynch 265 pounds. He squats 650 pounds. Smith, similar size, similar strength. And they both have played exceptionally well, I think, this season.
Play action fake, but Bryant under pressure. And he's gotten it away just off the hands of his tight end, Dugan.
Jeff Dugan, although he missed that reception, boy, is he a good blocker. I mean, and the coaches say this guy is a tremendous blocker. He's a tight end. And anytime you get a tight end who can be a dominating blocker there on the perimeter, you have a chance of a lot of big plays on the outside of the formation, on the perimeter defensive formation. And he's had a great year blocking.
Dugan, 6'4", 256, has 14 catches as well. We've seen Derek Fenner in the Maryland lineup, who had an appendectomy. They weren't sure whether he would be able to suit it up for the game of ball, but he is obviously in fine shape. Not much there on the running plays. They try to pick it up on a second down run. Bruce Perry met right at the gap and driven back by Washington.
And Adam Lenort, number 10, the middle linebacker, hit him too. You know, first of all, Ben Lynch keeps people away from Lenort. And then Lenort just stops him right in his tracks. Now, Lenort, number 10, the middle linebacker, he had a really productive first year. I see 135 tackles in his first year as a starter. Did a lot of things well.
From the shotgun on third and long. Matt Bryan steps into the pocket, but overthrows his intended receiver incomplete. Yeah. It was intended for JoJo Walker, way over his head, defended by Frazier.
Lance Frazier, number 19 for the West Virginia Mountaineers. This is a guy that Jeff Castile says, I wish I had 11 of this guy. And he's had a great career there as a punt returner, as a defender against Pittsburgh. He was amazing. An interception, a 72-yard punt return. You know, a great tackling game, caused a fumble.
He is a Floridian, too, yep. From Delray Beach, Florida, Spanish River High School. Low snap to Podlesh, but he gets it underway toward Frazier. Frazier runs into his own man and is decked the 18-yard line. Brian King, one of the best tackles of the day. Unfortunately, it was his own man.
Yeah, he's a good tackler.
34-yard punt, no return. Frazier has a rude greeting from his teammate. Ouch! Mountaineers will have it when we return, trailing by 3. Maryland in the Toyota Gator Bowl. You're looking at the shot from the MetLife blimp Snoopy 1 above the skies of Jacksonville and Alltel Stadium. Typically cruising about 35 miles an hour at 1,200 feet. The MetLife blimp Snoopy 1 giving us our aerial pictures today on a beautiful afternoon in Jacksonville.
Chamber of Commerce could be nice.
West Virginia takes over for the second time. 5:35 left in the opening quarter. 3-0 Maryland. The numbers on Marshall this season. From his own 17. And shooting the ball downfield and way over the head again of his receiver. That was Aaron Neal. Neal getting the start today, the senior from Ventura, California. And of course, Rich Rodriguez, his spread offense. Incomplete. He's the Big East Coach of the Year, and Rodriguez has paid his dues. He is a West Virginia grad. He got his first job at NAIA Salem College. When he was 24 years old, he said some of his players were older than he was. In fact, one of the players on his team he had played against in high school. And had a year under his belt, things going pretty well. On a second down give here to Quincy Woodson. A fumble the football and recovered by Maryland. Sean Merriman is the man that picked up the fumble from actually K.J. Harris, who gets his first carry of the game. So Harris fumbles, Merriman recovers the first turnover of the game.
Yeah, and this is one of those things, this Maryland defense, we talked about, the number one ranked in four different categories in the ACC, and another thing they do is force a lot of turnovers. Harris, number one, you know, has the ball pretty well secured. Took a helmet, it looked like, on the ball.
I think that was Denard Wilson.
Yeah, Wilson, the strong safety, and then Merriman, the hustling defensive end, makes the recovery and gets the Terrapins great field position.
32-yard line of West Virginia. McBride on first down. Hands to Perry. Perry with a cutback. And stopped at about the 26-yard line by Pac-Man Jones.
Talk about, you know, one thing is you force the turnovers, then what do you do with them? You see, Maryland have turned 18 turnovers into 38 points. opponents have done incredible. 73 points off turnovers.
Second and five for the Terrapins. Perry, the lone setback. Handed to him. Hit at the line of scrimmage. Still managed to turn out to the 25-yard line. Put the ball on the ground, but the Terrapins got it back.
You know, Bruce Perry is, you know, over 200 pounds, about 205 pounds. And, you know, we talked about his vision and the acceleration, but he's strong, too. Really breaks a lot of tackles.
Highly recruited prep All-American player from George Washington High School in Philadelphia, and chose Maryland because of its proximity to his hometown, the fact that his family could get down to College Park to see him play.
So Wake Forest is happy to see him graduate, because 276 yards as a sophomore and 237 this year.
4 minutes to go, first quarter. This is a third and four. Option. Toss on the ground, still loose. Flag is down, and Perry recovered for Maryland. That's two consecutive fumbles that the Terrapins have recovered of their own after getting the West Virginia turnover.
Well, it may have been a block in the back by Harrison, Latrez Harrison, but I think Grant Wiley really caused the problem.
Rodriguez says the penalty should be declined. By the way, our crew is from the Southeastern Conference. Rogers Redding, 31-year veteran, in his last game as the referee today.
Yeah, Grant Wiley, number six, has had four terrific
illegal
years.
Illegal crackback block against the offense. That penalty is declined. Fourth down.
Yeah, Grant Wiley was clipped. He was blocked in the back and then caused the fumble. But he's kind of doing that all year. Seven forced fumbles this year for the Mountaineers. Going to be their all-time leading tackler before today is finished.
So on fourth down, Novak, who hit a 26-yarder earlier, is set up for 51 yards, as long as the season, 54. On its way, and it is... No good. Wide right. So the West Virginia turnover does not cost the Mountaineers any points, as Maryland looked out of sync after recovering the Mountaineer fumble. They had a couple of near turnovers themselves and settled for the long field goal attempt by Novak. That is wide right. And the score remains Maryland 3 and West Virginia nothing in the Toyota Gator Bowl. Henry, their talented receiver, making his first appearance in the Mountaineer lineup.
He is absolutely a difference maker.
Hand off on first down to Quincy Wilson, stopped by DeQuell Jackson.
You know, only the second carry for Quincy Wilson, and Rich Rodriguez knows he has to get Quincy Wilson the ball. He's one of those guys that gets stronger and stronger and stronger. Three times this year, he's carried the ball over 32 times. The 140 attempt game against Rutgers.
Typical no huddle for West Virginia, this time looking like speed up the tempo a little bit as Marshall backs away from center and changes the play. Again to Wilson, tries to cut back, wrapped up by Jackson again and several of his teammates. And just to finish the story on Coach Rodriguez, Coach Rod as they call him, we were speaking before that last fumble by the Mountaineers when he was a 24-year-old head coach at Salem, had a pretty good year under his belt and decided to buy a house to propose to his girlfriend, and he hears a phone call from a friend, a coaching friend, that says, hey, what do you think about this Japanese outfit buying Salem and eliminating football? He said, what? The athletic director came in and says there'll be an announcement today detrimental to your program. So, well, I guess so. Salem dropped football as another fumble by West Virginia and recovered by Maryland. I'm going to get that story in yet.
I don't think you're going to finish it. I think Rasheed Marshall just got absolutely drilled.
Madu Williams was the man that did the drilling, and Andrew Henley recovered the fumble.
You know, this was a clever little play, had what would have been their very first down of the game, and just gets absolutely killed. Madu Williams was part of that hit as well. The strong safety, Denard Wilson. Yeah, it was number
Williams.
10, Williams.
Got the shoulder pad right to the helmet. Wow.
I don't think Coach Rod wants me to tell that story about his...
Just forget it.
Every time I tell it, they fumble. Here's Josh Allen in the backfield for the first time. He averages over 5 yards a carry, as does Perry. And here is Allen with his first tote of the day. Lucky to get back to the line of scrimmage.
I tell you what a blessing that Charlie Taft, the offensive coordinator, has to be able to have these two guys, Bruce Perry and Josh Allen, who said combined over 1,600 yards, 14 touchdowns. And Josh Allen, he had 257 yards rushing against Virginia, top rushing performance in the ACC during the year.
And third all-time at Maryland.
Here's Charlie Taft.
Second and 10 after no gain by Allen on first down. Well, did Kyle Schmidt squeeze that one? Craig Wilson came across from West Virginia. Was he drawn or not?
So we had a good chance to talk to Kyle Schmidt yesterday.
We have a dead ball foul offside against the defense. The player made contact in the neutral zone. 5 yard penalty, still second down.
That's twice. Yep. Kyle is prompted an offside.
From Derry, Pennsylvania.
Yeah, not Latrobe.
Not Latrobe.
That's the big rival.
Yeah.
They list his hometown as Latrobe. We mentioned that. He said, I'm from Derry. There you go. We even corrected the graphic.
Yeah. But, you know, he was a fun guy. He says, hey, what I look forward to, like nothing else, is game day. You know, just love football. He said, for me, an offensive lineman, what we really look for is just being able to look at the statistics and having a good rushing day. You know, I'm not going to catch balls. I'm not going to throw them. But we have a good rushing day. I know we played well.
Blitz comes. Picked up. Pass to Suter, complete. He has a first down down the sideline, close to the 35-yard line, where Lance Frazier forces him out of bounds.
Yeah, Steve Suter, you know, clever way to use him and his speed. He's not terribly large at 5'10", 190 pounds, but it's like a run, and he makes the first guy miss just like he does on punt returns. Up here at the top, big cushion, get him the ball quickly, get a couple of blocks, good block here, makes that guy miss for an easy first down. 15 yards per touch over the last 2 years for Steve Suter.
From the 37, first down for the Terrapins inside the final minute of the first quarter. Pump fake for McBrien, now going to the end zone, but nobody home. That one way off the mark, intended for Suter.
And once again, Brian King, number 11, the free safety. You mentioned him, he being the roommate of Scott McBrien a few years ago when they were at West Virginia together. Brian King, he has had another one of those Mountaineer defenders like Grant Wiley, four-year starter, you know, 3 years as a corner. Got his first start at safety against Miami. How would you like to have your first start at safety against Miami? But, you know, over 100 tackles on the year, 6 interceptions. Has done just about everything well for the Mountaineers.
And a native of Maryland, as you see, Damascus, Maryland. Not too many can move from corner to safety, be effective. He has been. Parson on the reception. Rich Parsons' first catch. He had 17 during the regular season.
How about that little clever little play? Part reception, part pitch. I think it was a completion. Well, that's interesting. Again, the little fake into the line to Allen. And then Parson, who had lined up in the slot, comes back and really kind of takes a shovel pass
right
from McBrien.
It's third down and 4. McBrien from the gun. West Virginia shows blitz. Picked up by Maryland, and McBrien has his man. Caught by Williams, and Jafar Williams, touchdown.
This starts with a good protection again. Good block here. Steps underneath it. Wide open Jafar Williams against a zone defense. Just kind of ran all the way across the field from right to left. Gets the ball to break the plane. And the Terrapins are on the board again.
31-yard touchdown pass. McBrien to Williams. And Novak for the extra point. Kicks it up and through. So the turnover. West Virginia fumbles. Maryland recovers and ends the first quarter with a touchdown pass, McBrien to Williams.
West Virginia held without a first down in that opening quarter, and Maryland that time taking advantage of the turnover to add to their lead. The senior from Philadelphia, Jafar Williams, with a touchdown at the end of one quarter, 10-0 Maryland. How he threw a touchdown pass to end the first quarter and put the Terrapins up 10-0 on West Virginia in the 2004 Toyota Gator Bowl. That was a five-play drive after the recovery of the Marshall fumble. And Novak with a kickoff. Pac-Man Jones takes it deep in the end zone and will down it there. Touchback. Coach Rodriguez out to the 20-yard line now.
You want to finish?
24-year-old Salem College, the head coach. They drop football. You take it. I'm not going to try it this time.
It's a story that has no end. So they drop football because the Japanese bought his school. So then he becomes a volunteer coach at West Virginia for Don Nealon. And the interesting thing about the volunteer coach, he had actually taught driver's ed. Every morning, 6:30 to 1:30, then we'd rush over to practice. Did that for a year. Then got the job at Glenville State for 7 years with a real good program there. Ultimately hooked up with the Bowdens and at Clemson and at Tulane. And then ultimately the head coach here, and really has this program very much on the rise. Two very good seasons back-to-back for Rich Rodriguez.
Two coaches coaching at their alma mater squaring off today. Diving attempt made, but incomplete. It was Henderson that had a bead on it, defended by Cox, but Marshall unable to hit him, and West Virginia has gone one play into the second quarter and still does not have a first down.
Yeah, that ball is catchable. Tough catch for Henderson, but a good throw by Rasheed Marshall away from Cox, the defender. And yeah, very catchable. You know, they've had, this is their fourth possession for West Virginia, 9 total plays on the 3 prior possessions. The first one was 3 and out, and then 2 fumbles. Well, you told that story.
Hand off to Harris. Or was it Wiley? Let's see. I think it was Wilson, excuse me. Joe, the tackle for Maryland. So there is Quincy Wilson, yet to get untracked, the All-Big East performer.
Rich Rodriguez and one of his assistants signaling plays. We'll talk more about that. Every play comes in from the sideline and they run the no huddle.
Marshall being chased and hit hard, driven out of bounds at the 25-yard line by Andrew Smith.
Rich Rodriguez signals in the plays from the sideline, and this was one of those plays where Marshall, very good on the move. It's a run-pass option. Before he gets out of bounds, it's a legal hit.
And Maryland once again making sure that Marshall unable to get that running ability of his untracked.
Yeah, that's what they're hopeful of today.
James punt towards Suter, who backpedals to take it at about the 23-yard line. Steve Suter gets to the outside, uses his blockers well. Now a convoy for Suter. Down the sideline, he'll take it all the way for the touchdown.
His 6th punt return touchdown in his career. His 2nd this year. You know, Tom, some guys just have a knack. You make the first guy miss. He's got great speed, but there were some really, really good blocks thrown. No clips. Good block at the end by Madu Williams, number 10.
He had a 75-yard punt return TD against the Citadel. And that one, 76 yards against West Virginia in the Gator Bowl. Extra point from Novak. And dead center. On the sideline, Suter, the junior from Manchester, Maryland, accepting congratulations after this 76-yard punt return. Zigzagging in and out, a bit down the sideline, picking up his blockers and waltzing into the end zone to make it 7. Charles Schwab, seeing the market from a different perspective, yours. And by Aflac. Ask about it at work. Maryland leading West Virginia 17-0. This is starting to take on the flavor of the regular season meeting between the two.
You know, and I really thought for West Virginia, they're going to have to stop the run, which they've not done particularly well today, and then get the ball to Chris Henry. I don't think Chris has caught a ball yet today.
And Steve Suter with the 76-yard punt return for the touchdown. Novak will kick it off for the Terrapins with Jones and Brian Wright deep for the Mountaineers. Mountaineers looking for a big play to get them started. This will be Pac-Man. And a nice return. 28-yard line as we revisit the touchdown on the punt return by Suter.
Yeah, this was a fun one. I mean, he got a couple of good early blocks. I think one by Andrew Henley right up here. And then you see a big gaping hole there. I mean, just a little late coverage by the Mountaineers. The speed allows him to miss a guy there. And then late in the run, he picks up a block there. That was Madu Williams. But, you know, when you do it six times, you know you have good speed. You know you're going to make the first guy miss. And he never calls for a fair catch.
See why.
Yeah.
First down play for the Mountaineers, needing to get untracked. Quincy Wilson, can he turn the corner? Gets 5 yards on first down, driven out of bounds. And Suter has a pregame ritual, which is not the most pleasant thing you've heard of. He was greeted by Lewis before the game today.
In honor of your pregame ritual, which I know is about to happen right now, here's a little souvenir for you from the Gator Bowl, huh?
Very.
All right, man, go fill it up, huh?
He gets a little ill before each game, is the point. It's something that Norman Rockwell would not paint, Tom.
It's done that ever since high school. Nothing in the middle, so Wilson bounces to the outside, picks up the initial first down for the Mountaineers. He is close to midfield, stopped at about the 47 by Dominique Foxworth. And with 13 and a half minutes to go in the first half, the initial first down for the Mountaineers.
Yeah, any time you're down 17-0, you're looking for any ray of hope or a positive, and that's one of them. Again, Rich Rodriguez needs Quincy Wilson to be a factor in this game. When you're down 17-0, it kind of takes your great running back out of the game, perhaps too early.
Three wide receiver formation, empty backfield. Marshall with a quarterback draw. Maryland not fooled, loss of a couple. I think it was Feldheim who's the first to hit him, and Maryland not fooled at all by the quarterback draw from an empty backfield.
Yeah, C.J. Feldheim, the nose tackle for the Terps. Hurt his knee last year. Got off to a slow start, but like the rest of his teammates, played very well the second half of this season.
K.J. Harris. K.J. Harris in a tailback with four wide receivers. Marshall's under center. Harris with a cutback. K.J. Harris, nice run. Crosses midfield down to the Maryland 44-yard line where Madu Williams makes the stop.
Although K.J. Harris fumbled earlier, this guy's had a real good season. I mean, he's a big back with some speed, a very good pass receiver. Against Miami, boy, did he have a big game. 234 all-purpose yards against Miami in the near win by the Mountaineers.
And for the season, averages 5.5 per carry. The good blocking fullback, Mo Fofana, is in front of Harris in the backfield. Third and 2. Harris trying to use it for Fofana block, hit behind the line and unable to make the first down. Stopped by Leon Joe, who got penetration into the West Virginia backfield.
Leon Joe, number 32 for Maryland. You know, he's strong. We've seen how fast he is. And he's played consistently well this season.
Fourth down and a long yard. Both Wilson and Harris lining up in the backfield here. Looks like West Virginia is going to go for it.
Well, you know, down 17-0. Yep. I think with this kind of field position, you have to.
Now, not a whole lot of choice.
We've got a good running quarterback and a good tailback in Wilson. You see, there's the audible. The audible's called from the sideline, not by Rasheed Marshall. And he's going to use their third timeout.
So their final timeout of the half as the play clock was ticking down and they tried to change the play. A 4th-and-1, they didn't want to make a mistake on it. Didn't want to get the 5-yard penalty. So they'll discuss it on the sideline. Coach Rod and Rasheed Marshall. And it'll be fourth and one when we return to the Toyota Gator Bowl. 17-0 Terrapins, thanks to Steve Suter's punt return touchdown, the first in history for Maryland in a bowl game. Not much to cheer about for West Virginia yet. And they're facing a fourth and one. They've converted 40% this season. So from the 44-yard line of Maryland, fourth down and one for West Virginia. They're going to go for it. From the shotgun, Marshall with both Wilson and Harris flanking him.
There's the audible as he looks to the sideline. He may punt it. He's done this earlier in the year.
He backed up, you saw, a little deeper, and does with a little pooch punt. Takes a West Virginia bounce momentarily. Will be down to the 19-yard line. So Coach Rock got a look at the formation. Yep. Fourth and one. Gave the signal to Marshall, back up and do the pooch punt. 27 yards on the punt.
Well, most January 1st bowl games are filled with a lot of intensity and plays. We certainly have seen that thus far in the first half. Marshall took a shot from Madu Williams in the first quarter, caused a fumble. Jerome Cox on the outside, and Grant Wiley, he's always intense, even on Monday through Fridays. It's not just Saturdays.
I think what happens with the long layoff after the last game, they're all ready to play. They're tired of practicing and ready to get on the field. That's why they're so intense. Play action fake, McBrien, first down pass. Is that good? Sparkling catch if it is by Williams, and it is a catch. So Jafar Williams, who had a touchdown reception earlier, with a nice looking grab on first down.
Yeah, he was a starter earlier in his career for Maryland. And, you know, this was really a good catch. Away from his body. You know, when he scored on that touchdown, I thought he did a really nice job of getting the ball, you know, into
broke
the end zone.
Yeah.
Otherwise, he goes out on the 1 yard line.
Brian King had a hit on him at the 1 yard line, but he reaches over to get it across the plane of the goal line for the touchdown and then makes a stretched out catch there. McBride, another play action fake. His pass to a wide open receiver. And shaking people is Davis. And Davis trying to reverse his field again. Still on his feet.
Oh, man. Inside
the 40-yard line of West Virginia.
Yeah, he is a true freshman. And Charlie Taft, the offensive coordinator, was talking to us about a week ago about Vernon Davis and said they are really excited about him. And you see what? An exceptional high school athlete, played six different positions last year, including returning kicks, and ran a 10-700 meters. Tom, this guy has, you know, one of those big upsides you talk about. Plays their H-back position. Just a freshman.
Freshman from the Washington, D.C. area. 28 yards on that one as Maryland continues to chew on big chunks of yardage. Here's Perry. His cutback gets him to the 35-yard line, perhaps just inside it.
As you watch Scott McBrien, the left-handed number seven, does it remind you any other player that at Maryland from years past?
In the red uniform, lefty, number seven. Let's see. Was he blonde?
Yeah, he was. Yeah. Well, Boomer Esiason. And a lot of the same kind of statistics, the same throwing motions, the same leadership characteristics.
Scott hopes he can follow Boomer's example to make it to the NFL. Keeps here and then pitches back. It's Parson. And another good play for Maryland. A gain of 12 yards.
Well, in the mid-80s, it was the great blonde one, Boomer Esiason, who played so well for the Maryland Terrapins. There he is, the old lefty. Again, just always calm in the pocket was Boomer and his days there. And McBrien is the same way. Quiet leader, thoughtful, smart. A lot of similarities between the two.
Boomer's senior season, he threw 15 touchdown passes. McBrien has thrown 16. And Ralph Friedgen telling us that earlier it was a little frustrating for him because McBrien practiced better than any quarterback he had ever had. Didn't always translate to performance in the game, and now it has here late in his senior season. He hopes to make it in the NFL. Said he knew he wouldn't be drafted highly, if at all, but he hoped to get a chance to make it at the next level. That was a carry by Perry, stopped by Lenort.
And what did Ralph Friedgen say to us yesterday about, you know, all of his quarterbacks, including McBrien? Said, if you play quarterback for me, you have to have heart, you have to be tough, and you have to be able to see the field, the entire field. He said, Scott McBrien's done that.
Because Ralph knows about quarterbacks, right?
Yeah.
He was a quarterback.
He played.
Yeah, no, I'm not kidding.
He was a quarterback in high school. Came to Maryland as a quarterback, left as an offensive guard. And a pretty doggone good one.
Second down and eight. McBrien's pass on the slant is complete. Caught by Williams. Fumble.
And I think McBrien recovered it.
That's three times that Maryland has lost the ball only to recover the fumble.
You're keeping track.
Yeah.
This is a good start.
2004 and clean slate.
It's big for you. It's a very good first point you've made. Try to double your total from last year.
That ball might have been
tipped a little bit, wouldn't it?
Yeah, tipped a little bit at the line of scrimmage. And then McBrien heads up play, yeah. Keeping his head in the game. It sets up a third and nine. Ball at the West Virginia 22. The Mountaineers can't afford to surrender any more points. From the gun, McBrien pumps once, twice, has a man wide open. Catch made by Williams. Another touchdown.
Wow. That's a little too easy. But great, great protection for Scott McBrien. Waited 6-7 seconds to get that ball off. So Dumas, the right tackle, Bryant, Smith, Brooks, Heyer, the offensive lineman right up here in between the corner and the safety. And that's a good corner in Lance Frazier and Brian King, the free safety. Two pretty good players.
Frazier just turned him loose. Was he expecting deep help?
And he was expecting deep help from Brian King, but the ball was thrown just in the right angle to get in between the two players.
22-yard touchdown, extra point good by Novak. And the rout is on in the Toyota Gator Bowl with 7:49 to go till halftime. The Terrapins socking it to the Mountaineers. Williams with his second touchdown of the first half. And the Terrapins increase their lead. McBrien with another touchdown heave. And Maryland goes up 24-0. 24-0. Remember, they lost 34-7 in the regular season to Maryland. Javar Williams with two touchdown receptions for Ralph Regan already here in the first half. Novak will kick it to Jones or Wright. They'll bring it out of the end zone. This is Wright. Crosses the 20 to the 22-yard line. And it's time for today's trivia question presented by Aflac. Here is our Aflac trivia quiz. Last time Maryland and West Virginia were both in a New Year's Day bowl game. When was the last time Maryland and West Virginia were both in a New Year's Day bowl game?
Are you asking that to me or anybody?
Well, anybody, yeah. But if you know, pipe up.
Give me some time. Can I get back to you next January? Some research.
First five drives for the Mountaineers. The longest has been only five plays. From the shotgun, a hand to Harris. Harris trying to turn the corner. Let's churn out a couple of yards.
You know, Maryland has really flipped the game for West Virginia. West Virginia really wants to run the ball, but down 24-0, you can't. I don't think. They're only one of four throwing for 5 yards. And Chris Henry, their outstanding wide receiver, particularly the second half of the year, has not touched the ball yet. And if they're going to have any chance of getting back in the ball game, I believe he's the guy that's going to have to be a factor.
Mountaineers had one of their primary receivers, Travis Garvin, suspended for the first half of the game by Coach Rodriguez. Originally, he said he was going to have to sit out the whole game and reinstated him for the second half. Wilson on the swing pass, thrown for a big loss by the Terrapin defense. We told you this was a talented defense. They've shown it so far. Jamal Cochran was the first man to counter Wilson there.
Yeah, and help with Leon and Joe. Boy, Cochran and Joe with, you know, great speed.
It's going to be third and long, and it's not good when you have more turnovers than first downs.
It's never good. Gary Blackie, the defensive coordinator, has just done a great job, not only today, this whole season, with this Terrapin defense.
Marshall from the gun, third down and 15.
Just a two-man rush.
And a quarterback draw. Marshall does get it out across the 30-yard line. He's going to be short of the first down by a couple of yards.
A two-man rush, and the nose tackle was, you know, that old spy routine that he was spying Rasheed Marshall on the run, but Sheet Marshall nearly made the first down anyway.
31.
Dickerson and Williams finally collar him after the best play of the day so far for West Virginia.
Fourth down, I think go for it here. They have the punt team out, which surprises me being down 24-0, Tom, I have to admit.
Well, it's so deep in their territory, I guess, that temptation was there on fourth and one. But instead, James will punt to Suter. And all he has done is take 176 yards for a score.
Late flag. Too much time. And now they're definitely going to punt. But Todd James is a punter.
Dead ball foul. Delay of the game against the offense. A 25-second clock expired. 5-yard penalty is still fourth down.
Remember, they burned two timeouts on special teams player. That time they let the clock run out. But Todd James, you know, had his very first punt of the season blocked against Wisconsin. But then special teams actually became a strength for the most part for the Mountaineers. That's what he calls a rugby kick. There it is. This is a rugby-style punt of his.
Line drive taken by Suter. Dodges one, two, three, four, and then ducks out of bounds just to taunt them a little bit.
Part punt returner, part hummingbird.
All that went for zero return yards after a 38-yard rugby punt.
You know, we were talking to the coaches about Suter as a punt returner. Said this guy just does not fair catch it. And perhaps he should have, but it was entertaining to watch nonetheless.
Like a little gnat.
Yeah.
Suter dodging the fly swatters and getting out of bounds. Nice to see that feature that you did, Jimmy, on Army football. It's a pretty special piece that I hope you'll catch at halftime. And Army is a special place, especially football, too. So much history, Mikey Stadium and on brave old Army team. How important Army football has been in the history of our country, really.
Three Heisman Trophy winners, I think 71 All-Americans.
And several of our prominent military leaders got their training on the gridiron at Army.
Absolutely.
Intended for Parson, incomplete.
Now speaking of Army, I think there's no better football game than Army-Navy. You know, even when the record is, they don't have good records. I mean, for those guys, the game means more than any game football game I've ever been around.
Some Navy people here from the Jacksonville area, a submarine base, a naval air station. Had a big flyover before the game today. West Virginia and Maryland, the two submarines, are here in honor of the Gator Bowl game as we hand to Bruce Perry. Perry turning the corner, stopped just short of the first down as he's driven out of bounds by King and Audina. And for more on the sailors present today, here's Lewis.
Well, Tom, I ran into one of those sailors coming into the stadium today. He was with the USS Maryland, and he said he found out 2 weeks ago that the state of Maryland had donated 200 tickets to all of them. Now, the ship itself is in maintenance, the sub is, and so that's how they got the day off. Now, the guys for the USS West Virginia, that sub is actually at sea, but the sub has two crews, so the crew that's off happened to be here. And I believe they're up in Section 404, just having a great time, a great surprise for them for New Year's Day.
Well, so the alternate crew is the one here. The sub, the boat, is not actually here, and it's a boat, not a ship. Perry, carrying tacklers with him, pounds out a first down. And Scott Jerko finally gets him to the turf. And just back to that feature on Army football, what about Bobby Ross taking the job at Army? That has to be a real morale boost for all the Army fans and the football program at Army. He is a very accomplished coach.
Yeah, and he and Ralph Regan, the head coach of Maryland, go way back. They coached together at the Citadel. They coached together at Maryland, at Georgia Tech, and the Chargers. And we talked to Ralph about Bobby going to Army. He says there's no better man for that job.
Only one first down for the Mountaineers to 12 for the Terps. Play action fake and McBrien follows Perry. I don't know if that was intended or not. Jerko.
Well, Scott Jerko, you just called number 33. One of 21 walk-ons. He's actually a scholarship player now, but a local kid born and raised in West Virginia. You know, always wanted to play for his home state school, walked on. You know, got a little special teams play, and now a starter. One of those good, you know, feel-good walk-on stories.
From Morgantown University High School. captain of the team there, all-stater, an all-star in both football and basketball, an engineering major in his junior season. McBrien just heaves it downfield, incomplete. A little bumping going on. And Frazier and Melendez, but incidental contact. Well, there is a penalty flag. I don't see it, but where is it?
I thought
is
it was good
on the sideline.
Yeah, they called a flag. I thought it threw a flag. I thought number 19 Frazier had
it.
Pretty good coverage.
Down at the 25-yard line, the official standing in front of it.
Gets his head turned. I don't think that's it. That is incidental. Had his head turned. I don't believe that should be pass interference on Frazier.
We have pass interference against the defense. The penalty is 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Well, it just continues a nightmare first half for the Mountaineers.
Jeff Castile, the defensive coordinator, was really raving about the four-year career of Lance Frazier. As a player, a leader, with five interceptions on the year, returned a punt for a TD. There's Jeff. But just like the first game, his defense is having a tough time controlling a well-executed multiple offensive Maryland.
Fourth penalty, 30 yards against West Virginia. Maryland has not been whistled for a penalty. JoJo Walker on the end around. We gave you earlier our Aflac trivia question. A little jawing going on. Not much West Virginia can say at this score. The last time Maryland and West Virginia both in a New Year's Day bowl game?
I'll take a guess. How about if I guess 1954?
Very good.
Yeah.
How did you do that? Maryland was in the Orange Bowl against Oklahoma. Oklahoma won 7-0, and West Virginia in the Sugar Bowl lost to Georgia Tech 42-19.
You know, these programs, both of them on the rise, and they're going to play, I think, in a lot of January 1st bowls.
Melendez with a catch. Dodging tacklers, close to the first down.
Well, West Virginia and the Big East, that whole conference is changing, Tom, and I really believe West Virginia is going to be one of the dominant schools, and Rich Rodriguez has got that program definitely on the rise.
And Maryland, too, and we mentioned that 54 loss in the Orange Bowl to Oklahoma, but despite that loss, that was national championship year for Maryland. Their 1953 season national champion.
Actually, this is not Ralph Regan's first Gator Bowl. He actually, in 1975, was in the stands.
As an assistant at the Citadel,
yeah,
right?
Watching the Terrapins play.
His alma mater. Flag down.
Scott McBrien's got a lot of bounce to him. You know, he looks like one of those guys that just
24 to nothing. Who wouldn't have a lot of bounce?
Yeah. Take a look at Ralph's career at,
yeah, dead ball
at Maryland. Through the years. Now, he came in as a quarterback, but that ended up a guard, all ACC as an academic, all academic ACC, then a graduate assistant, assistant coach, and they got the right man. You know, in 2000, they got the right man, 30-8 in his three seasons.
See Dr. Deborah Yao, the athletic director at Maryland, holding the jersey there when they named Ralph the coach. She made a good choice.
Well, you know, this is his place, his school. You know, he met his bride there as a graduate student. One of his children are about to go there.
Screen pass, complete. And another big gainer for the Maryland offense. Inside the 15, down to the 13-yard line is Derek Fenner. Gain of 16.
Yeah, these receivers are really good after the catch. Williams earlier, and you see Fenner now. And they get good blocks downfield by the others. A really good block there by number 9, JoJo Walker. See him come in and just level his guy. They're just hard to slow down.
Look at that.
Includes sacks.
Approaching the 2-minute mark in the first half. A first half dominated on both sides of the football by the Terrapins. McBrien lost the football.
It's live.
It's a live ball, I think.
Pick it up.
Then they're going to the flag down. Morello was the man that spun McBrien to the ground.
Mike Loretto off the corner on a blitz plays what they call their bandit position. They have a kind of an unusual defense, three down lineman, three linebackers, five defensive backs.
They have an illegal forward pass, intentional grounding against the offense. The penalty is loss of down at the spot of the foul, second down.
McBrien was credited with a pass, although illegal. Intentional grounding. I thought it might have been a live football.
Yeah, I don't know whether here comes the blitz off the back side here. Again, you know, the naked bootleg, and he was, I didn't think he was inside the tackle, right?
I think it was intentional grounding was the correct call. He wasn't outside the tackle box, was he?
But Lorello, it really comes off the corner. It's really one of the very few times he's been able to get to Scott McBrien early in the pass play.
It was a pass, illegal as it was. It was not a live football. Correct call made there. McBrien, bullet, almost intercepted. Should have been intercepted by Pac-Man Jones.
You see the A rather than the P on his jersey. His name is Adam Jones. His nickname, Pac-Man Jones.
Came about when he was a youngster, and they said he used to gobble up that bottle just like that Pac-Man. Remember the old video game?
Yeah. And then one of the, perfect read by Jones. This is one, boy, you have to catch. And, well, he had some room to run after he caught that ball.
Got his first start against Miami, of all people, as they found a way to get him into the starting lineup. And against Kellen Winslow, and all game long, Winslow kept saying, "Do you know my name? Do you know my name?" And Pac-Man kept quiet until in the end zone, he was able to intercept one and got up and said, "My name is Pac-Man."
You know, we had a nice visit with Pac-Man Jones yesterday. A good player, fun guy, confident guy. He's done things real well for West Virginia.
Melendez with that last reception for the Terps. Lance Frazier with the tackle. So on fourth down, a field goal attempt from Novak.
Yeah, they need a block. West Virginia needs a block. Something positive before halftime.
35-yard attempt. Novak puts it up, and he missed it.
Well, that's positive.
It was well within his range, but that one no good. So you can build on it if you can. 24-0, still, even with a 24-0 score, Ralph Friedgen has been exhorting his troops all this first half on the sideline. Let's listen.
Hey! Hey! Come on, let's go! We got two good field positions.
And on those good field positions, after sputtering on a fumble recovery earlier, they were able to get the touchdown.
Let them back in this thing now. Don't let up for 1 minute. You hear me?
Well, they haven't yet. West Virginia, six possessions, four punts, and two fumbles.
We've got a minute in the first half to try to get something positive.
And still number five, Chris Henry, has not had a ball thrown to him.
Quincy Wilson thrown back. And the tackler was Abari, the Tosin Abari, the man of Nigerian descent, who is a graduate student now and paying his way to the University of Maryland and a walk-on of the football team. Only the second first down of the first half for West Virginia, and it is Chris Henry with his first catch, as you said.
Yeah, you know, he's just one of those guys, Chris Henry, even when the score is 24-0, I think you have to give a couple of chances. You know, he's averaged 25 yards a catch this year. Just been a guy who can run, he can jump, he adjusts to the ball well. See what he's done the last seven games. That's when they won those games.
Approaching the 22nd mark as Marshall hangs it up down the sideline. It was intercepted by Williams, but out of bounds. Flag down.
They've got pushed right in front of the West Virginia bench.
Buck shows 15 seconds in this first half as we sort out the penalty.
Now West Virginia's had some long pass plays this year. Rasheed Marshall has thrown three pass completions of 83 yards or longer.
We had pass interference against the defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
And they need another long pass completion right now.
And in a hurry with 15 ticks left.
Now remember, they don't have any timeouts. Remember, they really burned two timeouts in the first 7 minutes of the game.
So you've got to go down the sideline. You can't go to the center of the field. Four wide receivers lined up in tandem to either side. Low snap picked up by Marshall. Hit as he throws, and it's caught on the deflection.
Get down.
Down to the 23-yard line is Chris Henry. And then Henry shoving a Maryland player, and a skirmish breaks out. Not a smart play. Joe tipped the ball and then recovered by Henry for 29 yards.
They waste those two timeouts. They got to get the ball spiked very quickly.
5 seconds.
And the chains halfway moved, so they should have plenty of time to spike the ball and at least get a field goal attempt.
So they did go to the center of the field. Clock stops on the first down. And then we'll be restarted. And those burn timeouts early have come back to haunt them.
Yeah, but West Virginia shouldn't be, they should be on the line of scrimmage. Spike the ball, they'll have time at least either for a shot for the end zone or a field goal attempt.
Ball will be marked ready for play when the chains are set. The clock will start, but first, an explanation here from Rogers Ready.
We have a dead ball foul, personal foul against the offense. We got a dead ball foul, personal foul against the defense. The foul's offset. First down.
As soon as he gets away from the ball, he's ready to play, he'll get it spiked.
Clock starts. And spiked. 3 seconds remaining.
But it's good time management with the no timeouts remaining. The receiver got down, give him a chance to at least the field goal attempt. Here, the ball was, I think, tipped.
By Joe.
Yeah. Joe's had a nice first half, hasn't he? But we talked about the ability to adjust, and Chris Henry, given enough chances, he's going to make some really good plays for you.
And Brad Cooper will attempt a 41-yard field goal. His longest of the year is 43, the former soccer player from Bowling Green, Kentucky. Interesting, as you saw Chris Henry go to the sideline, Coach Rod giving him a bit of a lecture, because as he got up after that 29-yard play, Maryland's called a timeout, by the way. He shoved a Maryland player, and he was lucky to get offsetting
right
fouls, or he would have negated the chance to get some points. And now in its 15th year of providing aerial television coverage of sporting and special events, the BetLife Blimp Snoopy One brings you these New Year's Day aerial shots over Jacksonville and the 59th annual Gator Bowl.
What a day.
Skies, beautiful. Alongside the St. John's River in downtown Jacksonville.
A few rivers in North America that flows north.
Mouth of the river not far from here, and originates with some lakes, I think, that feed it down in the Orlando area. Flows north to Jacksonville and out to sea. 41-yard field goal attempt by Brad Cooper. Fleming the long snapper, George Shell the holder. West Virginia trying to get something before halftime and another Maryland timeout.
You know, we've talked about it.
24-0, they're still trying to ice him.
Yeah. Freezing the kicker. I'm not so sure this ever works. You know, we talked to Brad Cooper yesterday. You saw his stats, 11-17. Really a high school soccer player, only played 1 year of high school football.
And while we have another timeout, we remind you that for more gridiron action, mark your calendars. Sunday, February 8th, the Arena Football League kicks off on NBC, the second year for the AFL on NBC coverage. And if you like fast-paced action, a lot of scoring, a lot of wild plays, a lot of hits off the sideboards, lots of action, that's the AFL on NBC, Sunday, February 8th.
If you like punting, do not watch it.
Yeah.
There's no punting. You know, and the kickoff returns are absolute scoring plays.
Off the net.
Yeah.
41-yard field goal attempt just before halftime, trying to get West Virginia on the board. Brad Cooper. Cooper's kick will be wide right. Not even close. And that pretty well sums up the first half for the Mountaineers. Coach Rodriguez looking at an injured player for his team being helped up. Jason Hardy, I think. And so the first half has ended as Hardy able to make it toward the locker room. Let's go down to Lewis.
All right, Tom, thanks a lot. Coach, how do you explain all the miscues, the mistakes, the fumbles, the things we've seen in the first half here?
It's really disheartening because, you know, you prepare all this, do a lot of hard work, you come out and you got to make them earn things. A team as good as Maryland, you can't give them anything. You got to make them earn it, and right now we're not doing that.
Will you have a speech with your defense and try and get them to get after McBrien because he's had so much time in the pocket to do what he's done?
He's had a lot of time. We've got to tackle a little bit better. And then offensive, we got to put something together. We got to get our defense a break and put some drives together.
All right, Coach, good luck. Thank you so much. Tom?
All right, an uphill battle for the Mountaineers. It's been all Maryland in the first half of the 2004 Toyota Gator Bowl. Terrapins 24-0. Now let's send you to Jimmy Roberts in our New York studio for the Allstate NBC Sports Update.
Get them back up after a near perfect first half.
Well, I don't think it was near perfect. I mean, we had some opportunities where we should have put points on the board and didn't do it. I mean, we had some great field position on turnover and didn't get it done. We got to play better than what we're playing right now.
So you're not happy with what they've done so far. You think they can do better?
No, I'm happy. I just, you know, when we get a turnover, I expect points. You know, we didn't get it.
There it is. Thanks, Coach. Tom?
All right, Lewis, coaches are never satisfied, as we well know, and the windage has affected the aim of the Mountaineers a lot today. They have been unable to score any bullseyes, while the Terps have not had to go inside the shell. They have been scampering up and down the field as much as a turtle can.
You're very good. You're very good. Nice force job there. But in the QB comparison, Scott McBrien had a real nice first half, 173 yards, two touchdowns. The 36 yards passing by Rashid Marshall really equals the entire passing yardage they had against Maryland in the first game. But in any case, that number is going to have to be much more significant if they're going to get back in the game. The good news is, Tom, they had the ball first.
And judging by the graphic we saw earlier on Coach Friedgen, they know how to put away opponents under Friedgen, 26-0 when leading at halftime, and the passing yards equal to that first meeting, 34-7 Maryland victory, and they scored the first 34 in that one, right?
Exactly. Well, you know, Coach Friedgen's teams, 26-0 when they're leading at halftime, but late this year, I mean, they won from behind, too. Their last two ball games, they won by coming from behind against North Carolina State and then Wake Forest. And, you know, we talked to Ralph the other day about his program. He thinks, hey, there's no reason that they can't consistently be a top 10 football team. He says, you know, we're situated between two big metropolitan areas in Baltimore and Washington, and a lot of good high school football players there.
And he welcomed the additions to the ACC. He said it's going to make us the premier conference, he thought, in college football. So things going well for Ralph Friedgen and the Maryland Terrapins in turning this football program around, on track to win their 10th game for the third consecutive season. Suter with a 76-yard punt return touchdown in this game.
Stomach's feeling a little better, too, after that punt return.
My stomach feels better when my team's ahead 24-0 usually.
Seven possessions today, four punts, a couple of turnovers, only three first downs. It just was not good. But you start a fresh half. You have an experienced quarterback in Rashid Marshall, a guy who's played well. There's the guy, Chris Henry, caught two catches in that last drive, one of a 38-yarder that set up a field goal attempt. So, again, you give him a few chances. And Quincy Wilson, you know, the surprise runner, too.
Half of West Virginia's yards and two of their three first downs happened on that last drive, which resulted in a missed field goal just before intermission. Rashid Marshall, the junior quarterback from Pittsburgh, went to Brashear High School and then Valley Forge Academy Prep School before coming to Morgantown. Had to wait for the halftime show participants to completely clear the field. Now it looks like we're ready to go.
And what Rich Rodriguez is hoping for is a big return on this kickoff. And they've had some this year. Pac-Man Jones, we said, that's number nine right there, had a kickoff return for a touchdown.
Ryan Wright is number 21. And Nick Novak is ready to kick it off to start the second half. Short kick. Pac-Man takes it on the fly. Dodges to the outside, found a little seam, and makes it to the 30-yard line.
Okay, they've got pretty good field position. And now that's the guy, Rashid Marshall, that's got to make it happen. He said to us just yesterday, hey, I've got to take more on myself. I've got to win this football game, running and throwing, calling a good game.
Well, you know, West Virginia has tasted adversity already this season. They began 1-4 before they reeled off seven straight wins, and they don't panic when things aren't going well. They don't start to change things, and that's what happened when they were 1-4. Didn't change the systems. They mixed personnel a little differently, and now they're more confident, more experienced, but they're facing a tough Maryland team, and especially their defense, as Quincy Wilson is able to get only a yard or so on first down.
You know, Rich Rodriguez was saying to us just yesterday that the two things that really turned that team around was the offensive line really gelled and came together, and then Chris Henry, the wide receiver, emerged.
Second down and nine. Marshall.
Oh, sacked. Mm. The nose tackle fell behind McKinney.
And Merriman got a piece as well, all the way back to the 20-yard line. Actually, they'll spot it at the 21.
I'll tell you, you know, Feldheim, number 96, has really been kind of a, really just kind of suck up the middle, just kind of really close up the middle. Hasn't been a great pass rusher, but right there against the center, Jeremy Hines, who's had a good year for the Mountaineers. But just a slip right off him and into the face of Marshall.
Play action fake from the shotgun, setting up the screen pass. Able to dodge a couple of tacklers, but well short of the first down, John Pennington. Only his sixth reception of the season to walk on. There's a marker down.
Pennington being a walk-on. Rich Rodriguez was a walk-on at West Virginia under Don Nealon. And has 21 walk-ons here suited up today. A big part of his program. Trying to do it West Virginia, much like the Nebraska teams have done for years. Have a good walk-on program. Get all those kids in-state to stay.
A lot of woofing going on down there. These are adjoining states and a pretty good rivalry. A lot of Maryland players on the West Virginia team.
It's maybe not the backyard brawl, but the side yard brawl, perhaps.
Yep. Rogers Redding in his final game as an official.
Rarely do you see an official with this letter on the back that matches his name.
Both names.
Yeah.
Why we have you along and spot things like that.
There's number six in front of him, Grant Wiley.
Yeah,
he talked about a guy that, you know, he wants to be
involved. He wants to officiate too.
Yeah, involved in every play, including all the officiating calls. Has almost made almost 300 unassisted tackles in his career at West Virginia. 158 coming into today's game.
And needed two coming in to be the all-time West Virginia leader.
We have two dead ball fouls after the play is over. Dead ball personal foul against the offense. Dead ball personal foul against the defense. Those fouls cancel. Fourth down.
My question is, why bother?
Yeah. You know, there's
torn the helmet off. That's a pretty good fire right there.
That's from the sideline. Top of the screen up here. Yeah. Just gets his helmet ripped off. Wow. That was the first.
I thought if you threw a punch, that was ejection.
Well, you know, you should never be punching with your helmet off. I
promise
you that.
We have a sideline warning against West Virginia. That is the first warning of the game.
Things are worse than that for the Mountaineers.
Yeah.
Sideline warning is one of their better moves of the day. They're facing a fourth down here and having to give the ball up, already trailing 24-0.
Perhaps another rugby punt by Todd James. He uses the rugby punt really to try to prevent big return. The ball was supposed to go about 25 yards, hit the ground, and then, you know, run forward another 10 or 15. We've seen it once from him today.
Averaging 40 yards, but remember, Suter took 176 yards for a score in the first half.
Rugby
punt. Low, bouncing,
yep.
Got the good bounce.
See, that's good strategy.
Yep.
Don't let Suter
keep it away from Suter. So good job on the punt all the way to the 20-yard line. That'll be 49 yards. Well, West Virginia on its first possession of the third quarter once again has to surrender the ball to the Terrapins. With our producer David Gibson, director John Gonzalez, Tom Hammond, Pat Hayden, Lewis Johnson at the Gator Bowl with our crack crew. Mike Hunniford, our spotter. The legendary Hall Time Zone Evans, University of Maryland graduate,
yes,
on the stats.
Did a turtle suit last night, Tennessee.
That's not funny to a Maryland graduate. Breaking to the outside, Bruce Perry. Perry again showing us that uncanny ability to keep his balance and bounce off tacklers and change direction. Finally forced out of bounds by Brian King.
You see him kind of shaking up his left arm and left shoulder. A lot of injuries over the last couple of years.
Don't say injury to Bruce Perry.
That's true.
This is a sore subject.
Ooh, the old abdominal strain. Oh, I hate when you tear that groin. Nice music in the background, too, from MASH, you know. Injured his shoulder, the high right ankle sprain, and then the sprained left ankle. There's a lot of things that have gone wrong for Bruce Perry.
All right, Hawkeye. Yeah. McBride's pass through the hands of Suter. Had a lot of steam on that one and a little high to boot, and Suter couldn't hold on, defended by Lance Frazier.
I'll tell you, the ball gets out of Scott McBride's hands pretty quickly. And, you know, you and I have talked about left-handers. They don't look like they're throwing the ball very hard, but it had a lot of velocity in that ball. Ball that Steve Suter should have caught and usually does.
Josh Allen has replaced Bruce Perry in the backfield on this third down play.
And West Virginia needs, you know, a defensive turnover right here. In this kind of field position, that leads to an easy score.
McBride wins it. Complete. Wide open Suter. Out of bounds in front of Frazier. Too easy.
Yeah, you know, and again, McBride felt and saw the blitz. Knew he had an out pattern out on the top of the screen to Steve Suter. Suter, you know, the pressure just didn't get there in time. Here comes Wiley and a bunch of other linebackers for West Virginia. They just can't get there in time because McBride saw it, felt it, knew he had the out route, threw it before Suter had broken off the route. That's perfect timing by McBride and Suter.
Gain of 15 yards as they look at Perry over on the sideline. McBride took a shot from Wiley after he let the ball go, but was able to get the 15-yarder and the first down. Another out. This one to Harrison. And Luttrell takes it out of bounds and then has a word or two for the West Virginia sideline.
Latres Harrison came to Maryland in 1999 as a well-thought-of quarterback out of Atlanta. You know, threw 27 touchdown passes his senior year and actually started a game at quarterback for the Terps against Florida State.
He's a prep All-American quarterback at Booker T. Washington High School, Atlanta area.
But, you know, now he's a true receiver. A year ago, he was kind of getting used to it, Tom, but now he had a real solid season.
Fumble. McBride able to dive back on it. And it's amazing that they've had, what now, three fumbles and have been able to recover them all.
We talked a little bit about this offensive line. We've seen some good offensive lines this year in college football, Tom. Just looked like McBride just kind of got out of there a little too quickly. Second time he's recovered a fumble himself. But Stephon Heyer, the left tackle, C.J. Brooks, the left guard, Kyle Smith, and then Lamar Bryant, Eric Dumas. Man, these guys have really played well this season.
I said three recovered. Obviously, it was four, as you saw the graphic. Bruce Perry is back. West Virginia jumped.
Go deep.
Misconnecting with Harrison.
Yeah, you just can't do that. You're down 24-0. It's third and six, and they bait you to jump offside.
Jason Hardy jumped offside.
And it's just one of those things in a quarterback's arsenal that you can use your voice inflection, and I think you save it for certain times. Yeah, Jeff Castillo, defensive coordinator, can't believe it. You know, you don't waste it on first down. You know, you wait for a third and five or third and six. And Kyle Smith, the center, let's see if his hands are moving. Oh, yeah, you see that little hand? He's kind of squeezing that ball, trying to get the guys to jump offside. We promised we wouldn't tell that story.
He's going to be angry with you.
Well, he's played well. He can be angry with me.
6'5", 300 pounds. You still want to
Absolutely. All ACC as a center, played guard a year ago.
Offensive linemen are the best, though.
He was a lot of fun.
They're just even keel, happy-go-lucky.
Big, lovable guys.
Stick together, hang out together.
Yeah.
Dance together in the locker room afterwards.
He's part of a singing group. He and Lamar Bryant, the right guard, and then C.J. Brooks plays guitar, the left guard. It's a large trio.
Perry picks up a first down for the Terrapins.
Lamar Bryant, the right guard, number 73.
That was a first down play.
And there's Brooks, but Lamar Bryant, number 73. Everybody tells me in the team, this guy has got a fantastic voice. Actually sings the national anthem at some sporting events at Maryland.
So that was a first down play. Second down and 8. 2-yard gain on first down by Bruce Perry, and he's replaced by Allen. As McBrien goes to the air and across the middle, ball came loose. Is it ruled a catch and a fumble or incomplete? No, incomplete pass to Josh Allen.
Well, Scott McBrien has a knack for playing well in bowl games. In last year's Peach Bowl, big win for the Terrapins over Tennessee. He was the MVP. He keeps playing like this, certainly going to get his share of votes.
Right, and his best friend, Brian King, on the other side at free safety. The two families got together earlier this week and went to dinner. And he said after the game there'll be a lot of hugs and photos and things, but right now it's all business. And Brian King was telling us that they've remained best friends despite McBrien leaving West Virginia and going to Maryland. Looked like he just wound up and threw it as hard as he could, as far as he could, and Suter, Suter on the deflection.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, pose for that one, 42 yards.
Oh, see what you can do in a light stomach, Tom? I mean, you talk about adjustment. I actually thought he maybe he could have been called for offensive pass interference. It looked like he throws Lance Frazier away, but remarkable adjustment. No, he just gets inside. It's good position. Gets his left hand up, yeah, stays alive.
He deflected it to himself, yeah, didn't he?
That's a fantastic catch. And, you know, if you're Lance Frazier, you got to be frustrated. You can't cover a guy any better than him, can you?
Well, the junior, Manchester, Maryland, has put on a show today. 4 catches, 83 yards, plus a 76-yard touchdown on a punt return. The shotgun. And Allen. Josh Allen turning away toward the goal line. And
I mean, he was
close, but not in, huh?
Yeah, churning away for the last 7 seconds. And he kept going forward because they didn't stop his progress. Just inside the 1-yard line. You know, for a run like that, you had to give him another chance. Watch 74, C.J. Brooks. And in 72, Kyle Smith. And it's a good. And then he becomes a lineman himself, Josh Allen. A real good pair of backs. Allen back for 2 more seasons for the Terrapins.
Second down, and going for about a yard away. Josh Allen hit the backfield and dropped that time. Lenort made a good play.
Yeah. We talked about Adam Lenort, their middle linebacker. When he's making plays like that, it usually means Ben Lynch, the nose tackle, is keeping people away. Lenort, good size at 6'3", in pretty good range. And, you know, very pleasant surprise for Jeff Castile, the defensive coordinator. Wasn't sure in your first year what you're getting, but Adam Lenort had a really solid season.
Third down. Play action fake. McBrien still has it. Racing for the corner of the end zone and the touchdown.
Well, he could have thrown for it, too. He had Derek Miller, the tight end, wide open, number 84.
That's the 6th rushing touchdown of this season, if you count this bowl game as part of the season, for Scott McBrien.
Well, he's well on his way. Scott McBrien is beating his former team for the 3rd time. Great call, terrific execution. Derek Miller was wide open in the back of the end zone, but McBrien said, hey, I've already thrown two. I'm going to run for one and then toss it to you, Derek.
And the extra point, Novak. Well, Rich Rodriguez of West Virginia said they were sorry to see Scott McBrien leave. I don't think they'll be sorry to see him leave College Park. He's thrown for a couple of touchdowns. He races into the end zone to score one on the ground. And there was a flag on the extra point attempt.
At the illegal participation, 12 men on the field against the defense, that penalty is declined. The extra point is good.
I don't know if he's talking to the president or not, but Scott McBrien has had a big afternoon leading the Terrapins, now up 31-0 on the Mountaineers. And Suter putting on a show, too, for the Terrapin fans. It won't be long before we're ready to get a little more AFL action under our belts. We had a great time doing the AFL on NBC last season, and those games are a whole lot of fun.
Well, you know, from the opening kickoff, you know, every offensive play is a scoring opportunity. It's absolutely incredible. I was talking to John Elway a little bit earlier this year. He's all fired up about his second season as the Denver owner.
Brian Wright, here's a reverse. Hand it to Jones. Pac-Man looking to pick up a block. Got one. Cuts back to the center of the field. Twisted down at about the 36-yard line. Raffle dazzle.
Nice call by Rich Rodriguez. Good execution by the Mountaineers. So Pac-Man, we talked about his kickoff return earlier in the year. He scored three different ways. Once on a kickoff, once on an interception, and once on a fumble return. Nice fake by Wright to Jones. You know, Rich Rodriguez, I know, is obviously very disappointed with the way this game has turned out, but some good things for next year. Young team, good young offensive line coming back. He's got Rasheed Marshall coming back. Chris Henry. Pac-Man Jones, you just saw. Some things to build on. The league changes a lot, too.
Yep. Best field position to start a drive all day for the Mountaineers. Marshall's pass across the middle. Short game to the 41-yard line to Quincy Wilson. Jackson with the tackle for Maryland.
You know, DeQuell Jackson, number 52, we haven't called his number a lot today, but really played, had a stellar season for the Terrapins, filled in for E.J. Henderson, their All-American middle linebacker. Weren't sure, you know, what they were going to get, but they said, you know, we expected to play the run pretty well, and he exceeded that, but what he's really done is been terrific in pass coverage.
In the first meeting against West Virginia, had 10 tackles and a sack. Marshall's pass complete. That'll be a Mountaineer first down.
Well, you know, just finishing the story there on DeQuell Jackson, number 52, is, you know, he did a lot of things well for a middle linebacker. Just not a limited run stopper. He had 7 tackles for losses, you know, a couple of sacks, a couple of interceptions, forced a fumble, even blocked a kick. So he's had a real good season for the Terrapins and back for a couple more.
Second team all ACC, leading tackler with 8 games in double figures this season. KJ Harris. Harris to the sideline. And wouldn't out of bounds around the 20-yard line by Denard Wilson.
KJ Harris, good athlete, played some minor league baseball. We've seen him as a powerful runner. He's a good pass receiver as well. Big hole. Good block by Dan Moses, left guard, and then Mike Watson. Left tackle.
KJ did spend 3 years in the Texas Rangers organization in Class A. 4 times was the state long jump champion in the state of Florida, Tampa Bay Tech High School.
Yeah, he weighs 240 pounds now, so he's one of those big athletes, soft hands. Talked about him being a good receiver.
Unable to get on track there. Went out to Garden City, Kansas Community College before coming back to Morgantown. Ambush and Joe combine on the tackle for Maryland. What about this name for a linebacker, Leroy Ambush?
Yeah, it's a perfect name. We literally bumped into his parents.
Literally.
His mom kept bumping into her at the hotel. They were excited about being down watching their son play.
In Frederick, Maryland, here's Chris Henry. And Henry to the 15-yard line. Tackled by Joe. Leon Joe, one of the seniors on this Maryland team. He's from Clinton, Maryland, one of 21 seniors playing their final game for the Terrapins today.
And he's played it well, hasn't he? He started off the very first play. Making a stop. Here comes the audible again in from the sidelines. All the things, including the audibles, coming in from the sidelines. Otto Graham really be upset.
Third down and 2. On the gun. A run by Marshall, who walks into the end zone, and West Virginia's on the board. KJ Harris made a nice block for him. And Rasheed Marshall, untouched into the Maryland end zone from 15 yards away.
Well, he said to us yesterday afternoon, I need to run the ball better, particularly if we're going to have a chance. Follows the block of KJ Harris, number one. Good block on the middle linebacker Jackson, and untouched in the end zone. A good drive for the Mountaineers.
Well, they got their best starting field position of the game and converted.
The boys had a huge lift for the defense, too, because the defense had been on the field so much in the first half. Got a nice rest here.
Brad Cooper's extra point is good. And West Virginia finally gets something positive. Marshall with the 15-yard touchdown scamper. Quarterback draw from the shotgun follows the block of K.J. Harris and takes it across the goal line for the first points of the day for the Mountaineers. Is engineered a 31-7 Maryland lead in the Gator Bowl, and his coach Ralph Friedgen talked about his senior quarterback.
I think he's really special. I really do. And I know we have other great quarterbacks in our league, but no other quarterback in our league has won as many games as Scott McBryant. And you can take all those other statistics that you want, but that's the one that's important to me. And to me, that's the mark of a good quarterback.
And he's looked awfully good today.
120 games as a starter the last 2 years. 21 if he pulls this one off today.
And Cooper with a kickoff for West Virginia's onside kick.
Oh, unbelievable. Oh, he almost caught it with one hand. I think it was
Pac-Man.
Pac-Man.
And there's a little shoving over on the...
Did they get the flag? Was there a flag?
Bench.
But you know, interesting onside kick selection. It was a line drive to Pac-Man Jones, who was on the far right-hand side. Bill Stewart's the quarterback coach and the special teams coach. He's on the far right is Jones. Kind of a line drive. Supposed to catch this in the air. And a perfect touch kick.
And he might have just gone right down the
sideline
unimpeded.
For a score. I mean, that was perfectly done by Brad Cooper, the kicker. You know, I've seen a lot of onside kicks. I've not seen that one. It has to take, you know, perfect timing. And I guess they're disagreeing about something, or?
Well, Pac-Man is known for his talking. In fact, Coach Rod even asked him to tone it down a little bit at one point this season.
Doesn't seem to be taking. That was a cool onside kick, though.
It was. And so close. Still trying to figure things out down on the field.
Bill Stewart, as I said, the quarterback's coach in special teams. Started off slowly in special teams, but really was an asset for most of the year. They did give up the punt return today.
We have two fouls. We have a live ball foul for a free kick out of bounds against the kicking team. After the play was over, we have a dead ball, unsportsmanlike conduct against the receiving team. The penalty, the first penalty is declined because the ball went out of bounds and will be put in play at that spot. Then we'll penalize 15 yards from the unsportsmanlike conduct, first down.
Pretty good explanation there from Rogers Redding. And again, Scott McBryant had drawing praise from his coach Ralph Friedgen, and right now Lewis is with his mom.
And I am, Tom, and I promised Kathy that I would not bug her in the first half. I kept my promises. She was so nervous about this game, but now she's more relaxed, as you were sort of relaxed about your son getting into football because you saw some things early, right?
Absolutely. When Scott was 10 months old, our very first Christmas, I purchased some toys for him to play with, and the only toy he wanted to play with was a Nerf football. He threw that football from that first day on, and I knew he had a gift to throw a ball.
And he was not heavily recruited coming out of high school, so he ends up in West Virginia. And talk about what he went through as he decided to leave, come over to Maryland, and have really a dream come true.
He had a wonderful 2 years at West Virginia under Coach Don Neal, and he really enjoyed his time there, and he decided to come home. and Maryland gave him a call, and he was comfortable when he went over and spoke with Coach Friedgen. So what a great experience he had being coached under two such outstanding coaches.
And I understand you all are not leaving right after the game. You're staying because he still has friends, and they're going to get together and play golf, right?
He has a lot of great friends at West Virginia, and he loves being with them, and they keep in touch all the time.
Sounds good. Enjoy the game, all right?
Thank you so much.
Okay, Tom, back up to you.
All right. And Brian King was his roommate. They were freshmen at West Virginia, and the moms engineered that. They met, the families met while they were on a recruiting visit to Morgantown, and the two moms said, let's have our sons as roommates, and Brian and Scott remain best friends.
You know, Brian King was telling us yesterday, you know, it's kind of a family affair for him too. His father, Steve, who is a 30-year retired police officer, comes down and spends, you know, weeks at a time with Brian and his brother, who is also at West Virginia. Just kind of hangs out, goes to all the games, every away game, every home game.
Scott Jerko was shaken up on the play, went to the sideline. Second down. But Brian, again wide open. This one to Josh Allen. And Allen cutting back toward the center of the field and just caught from behind at the 45-yard line of West Virginia. Gain of 27 yards. Frazier just able to trip him up.
You know, I look at some of these offenses in the ACC, North Carolina State and Maryland in particular. Those two, they're just so hard to defend because they do a lot of different things well. They throw the ball to the backs. They throw it to the tight ends. They run bootlegs. They throw it deep. You know, they can power the ball. They're just not one-dimensional. They can beat you two or three different ways. And just make it so hard to defend them. You just can't gang up on one thing.
Just over 5 minutes left in the third. First down run. Allen spinning. Net 2 or 3 yards on the move by Josh Allen. Mike Lorello, the tackle for West Virginia.
Stop by number 23, Mike Lorello.
And Maryland probably content to pound it on the ground as much as they can and let the clock tick away, leading 31-7. And inside 5 minutes to go, third quarter of the Gator Bowl. Still looking for its first Gator Bowl win in its fourth appearance. Nice play on defense that time as they had the option going. Allen winds up with the ball and is taken down for a loss on the play. The MetLife Blimp Snoopy 1 under the command of Captain Steve Wood and Chad Palmer with help from co-pilot Snoopy. The MetLife Blimps travel approximately 200 days a year visiting towns and cities throughout the U.S. Happy and healthy new year from the MetLife Blimp Snoopy 1.
And we've confirmed that that's the ship. Not, there's only one Snoopy, right?
Only one Snoopy.
Only one true Snoopy, the dog.
Leandre Washington made that nice play for West Virginia on defense, setting up this third down and long. From the shotgun, McBrien. Across the middle, breaking free. It'll be a touchdown for Fetter. Easy again for the Maryland offense. Derek Fetter from 50 yards gets the McBrien pass.
Did I see a flag down?
There is a flag down.
Flag down,
and it will be against Maryland.
Wow. You know, even the amazing thing to me, though, even though West Virginia came with a full-on blitz, Scott McBrien still got good protection, hung in there, and delivered the ball to Fenner.
We have an illegal formation against the offense. The offense did not have enough players on the line of scrimmage. 5-yard penalty.
You need 7 men on the line of scrimmage. They look like they had 6. At least that was the call. Brilliant pass protection all day. Again, this time for Scott McBrien against a blitz, too. This is a, you know, a safety blitz. He gets picked up by the tackle. So they're well coached. No one even near Scott McBrien. You know, with the blitz, you get the one-on-one coverage. Fanner runs a good route. Fanner really cuts off Adam Jones' inside shoulder. Catches the ball in the end zone. So started with great protection, didn't end with a touchdown, ended with a whole penalty. It was a good throw.
But the blitz pickup has been excellent today.
Superb.
By Maryland all afternoon long. McBrien, look at the arm strength. And it's caught downfield by Melendez.
Oh. I tell you, Scott McBrien is having some fun. I mean, at the end of that play, he actually jumped over Ben Lynch, who was on the field after he got hit.
44 yards this one covers.
Yeah, now Ben Lynch hits him there, but a little bit later he's going to jump right over his head. He sees the big completion. Hanging it up and over him. He didn't even want to run around him. Perfect throw again. This Maryland team is really throwing it to a lot of different wide receivers.
Lucky to get back to the line of scrimmage, if he indeed did. Warren Young made the stop, a redshirt freshman from 8 Mile, Alabama.
Seven different Terrapin players have caught a pass today.
Pretty impressive the way he spread the ball around.
Yeah, just kind of going on that theme, but who do you want to try to double team? Who do you want to stop?
Second down and 9 from the 11-yard line of the Mountaineers with 2.5 minutes left in the third quarter. Impressive Maryland showing today. And McBrien has hit 15 of 23 for 308 yards and a couple of touchdowns, scoring another one himself. Looking for his third touchdown pass. And was it caught by Fiddler, the fullback? It was. Didn't go for much, but again, an impressive catch, and that's what, the 8th receiver to catch a pass?
Yep. Bernie Fiddler, they're really a blocking fullback. Every once in a while, they get the ball to him in the flat. He took an absolute shot.
Somehow held on to the ball. That's his 6th catch of the season.
So those blocking back fullbacks. Oh, boy, I tell you, that's one of those tough positions you don't volunteer for, right? That nose tackle.
You never get any love from the coach who carries the ball every now and then.
Yeah, you never say, hey, coach, I want to be the blocking fullback or I want to be nose tackle. You just don't see that much.
McBrien heaved that one as hard as he could. That one had some zing on it. Went by JoJo Walker. Incomplete. Bringing up a 4th down and a field goal attempt.
And with a made field goal, it would make the score 34-7, which happened to be the score on September 20th when they last met.
Yes, except there's still a minute and a half left in the third quarter.
What's the point? Just a lot of time left, I know.
Nick Novak actually missed a couple of extra points late in the season there when he was wondering what happened, came back and hit a game winner. That field goal is good. Adding to the Maryland lead. Be a nice ride back to College Park after this showing in the Toyota Gator Bowl. 34-7. Still in the third with Maryland leading West Virginia 34-7. And coming up Saturday here on NBC, the U.S. Army All-American Bowl. Many of the current college stars made their debut on this stage. You'll recognize some of the names, like the best freshman quarterback in college football this year, Florida's Chris Leak, Virginia Tech's Kevin Jones, and Michigan's Marlon Jackson. Now time for a first look at Generation Next, including running back Adrian Peterson and quarterback Ted Ginn. Top high school football players show off their skills and commit to a college live on NBC, 1 p.m. Eastern this Saturday. I'm looking forward to seeing Brian Brohm, the quarterback from Louisville Trinity High School, who just led Trinity to another state championship, named by USA Today as the High School Player of the Year. He is said to have narrowed his college choices, as you see the kickoff to K.J. Harris in the West Virginia end zone. K.J. trying to get a return going.
Yeah.
Pretty good down the sideline. Brian Brohm, Louisville Trinity, is said to have narrowed his choices to Louisville, where his brother Jeff is on the staff, another former standout quarterback from Trinity and the University of Louisville, to Notre Dame, to Tennessee, and to Kentucky.
It's a good list of schools. Actually, the number one rated guy is this Adrian Peterson, rated by Tom Lemming, is the guru, and at a Palestine, Texas, had an unbelievable year for his high school team as well. He will also declare where he's going.
From the shotgun, Rashid Marshall, closing stages of the third quarter. Going to put it up. That's Henderson. Mikael Henderson can't hold on. Thought he might have gotten a bump there as the ball was hanging up in the air from Foxworth, but no flag.
Well, Henderson, number 83, is one of three or four real tall receivers that Rich Rodriguez has brought in. Just trying to get some physical mismatches in the passing game.
Henderson might have pushed off a little himself there as he tosses his helmet in frustration. Pass caught over by the sideline.
Marshall's pass.
Caught by D. Alston.
And you see this, they're always in this hurry-up offense, not when they're just down 34-7. Rich Rodriguez signals in the plays from the sideline. He signals the tempo first, then kind of the formation, the play, and oftentimes the audibles.
Nice pass on the run. Milo Austin makes the catch from Rashid Marshall, hit by Wilson. It's a gain of 17.
You see, there's a thing he does. They have three different type of tempos. That's the first thing he signals in, then the formation, then the play, and oftentimes the audible. And you see the wristbands that he wears. He has one red wristband on his right and a black on the left. And that's the kind of signal that the formation. He points to the ground. That means a play that was called, no audible. Right wristband, right formation, black wristband, the left formation. So it's a little unusual. He did this at Clemson. They did it at Tulane successfully.
And each of those three tempos is progressively faster.
Right. Fastest is called jet. You really get the ball snapped quickly. When you're down 34-7, you need to get a snap quickly.
And the third quarter has come to a close. Finds Coach Rod and the Mountaineers trailing Maryland 34-7, the same score by which they lost to the Terrapins back in September. And it's been keyed by Scott McBrien, the former Mountaineer, now a quarterback for Maryland. He set a Maryland single-game bowl record, passing for over 300 yards through three quarters.
Just 10 days, 100.
Impressive showing today by the Maryland Terrapins, leading West Virginia 34-7 in the Toyota Gator Bowl as the Terrapins continue their recent mastery of the Mountaineers.
This would be, what, four straight?
And this season, Pat, they have outscored West Virginia now 68-14. To midfield, a gain of a yard for Quincy Wilson. So that's a minus 54 against Maryland. Against their 11 other opponents other than Maryland this season, West Virginia is on the plus side by 140. They've outscored their opponents 362-222. So,
yeah, Rich Rodriguez said, hey, this is the best defensive team we've seen all year. And remember, they beat Virginia Tech, they beat Pittsburgh. Oh. Drop ball that would have been an easy first down and more on third and eight.
Milo Austin. And juggling the ball, had a lot of room to roam down that sideline. Coach Rodriguez was sort of upset with their showing down in Charlotte in the Continental Tire Bowl a season ago. He said they prepared well, but then they lost that hard edge late. And apparently the same things happened to him here.
Well, I don't have to tell you what, this is a tough matchup. Maryland has just done everything well, including this guy returning punts.
Suter to the 20. They got him that time for only an 8-yard return after a 39-yard punt. There's a flag down back at midfield.
It's getting like a preseason game now. You know, they beat you, they have a chance to beat you, Maryland. You know, offensively, defensively, we've seen it special teams. You know, most teams are one-dimensional, but they run it, they throw it, they possess the ball, yet they can get big plays.
Coach Friedgen told us, we talked to him, Pat, that his dad taught him that you can't be one-dimensional. You have to have balance. His dad was a coach, a high school coach, Harrison, New York, and said you can't be one-dimensional because if you...
We have an illegal formation against the kicking team, not enough players on the line of scrimmage. That penalty is declined. Maryland will have the ball first down.
And the coach said that if you can only pass or only run, if you can't be balanced, then the defense dictates to you what you must do.
And there he is as a high school quarterback, Ralph Friedgen, his father Ralph Sr., 30 years the football coach there. There he is, Ralph Sr., and Ralph Friedgen, the coach at Maryland, had a very, very close relationship with him. He talked about how his dad used to take him to all the games in New York.
Titans games, Jets games, Giants games. His dad somehow wrangled a press pass, and he would go to a scalper and get Ralph a ticket to sit in the stands and watch, and they'd meet at a designated place. And so Ralph got an early dose of football, of the high school variety, the college variety, and, of course, seeing those pro games in the New York area, too. Wound up going to Maryland, where he, when he was in graduate school, he met his bride there.
You know, and it's really taken. You know, the son of a coach, he's turned out to be, I think, one of the great coaches in football in the United States.
You know, after 31 years as an assistant, didn't think he'd ever get the chance, did he?
But if I were, you know, an NFL general manager or any AD in America, I would think about Ralph Friedgen. You know, I think he's obviously very happy at Maryland, but this is a guy that's been successful everywhere he's been.
Debbie Yao next door in the booth is not going to be pleased with you saying that.
No, I think he's going to stay. I mean, I think he loves his alma mater too much. But I'm just saying that this is a guy that's been successful for so long in so many different arenas, as we've talked about, so it's no accident. I think one of the fun things about Ralph, he was telling us, is that, you know, he really is interested in his athletes going to class, being good students, and he allows them to line up for meals according to their GPA. So all the 3 points and above, they get to the meal line first, and then it, you know, 2.5 to 3.0s, et cetera, et cetera. If you're below a 2 point, you don't get any meat. There's nothing left.
Fiddler with the catch from McBrien, and another first down easily for Maryland as they take it out to midfield. That's a gain of 24. Ralph said after 31 years as an assistant coach, he didn't think that the opportunity to be a head coach would ever happen. He tried to get some interviews at some places and really didn't happen. So he started building his retirement home in Georgia. He's on the Georgia Tech staff. And lo and behold, his alma mater gave him the call. And it was a quick process.
Well, they got the right guy. Boy. He's recruited well, and then he's coached him well. And, you know, among himself and his two coordinators, Gary Blackney on defense and Charlie Taff on offense, they've all been head coaches and over 100 years of coaching experience.
Bruce Perry with a first down run of about 8 yards.
So you got 102 years of experience among those three guys. All have been head coaches. You know, Ralph was always known as a coordinator, as a great play caller. And we asked him, hey, was it trouble for you giving up the play calling? He said, not when you have a guy like Charlie Taft. So we think exactly the same.
And Maryland calls a timeout here with 12:14 left in the fourth quarter. And the Terrapins on cruise control behind their senior quarterback, Scott McBrien, playing his last game in a Terrapin uniform. 34-7. New Toyota Tundra double cab, not just big, life-sized. And by City Identity Theft Solutions, free help getting your life back. That's using your card wisely. Tom Hammond, Pat Hayden, Lewis Johnson at Alltel Stadium, Jacksonville, Florida. 2004 Toyota Gator Bowl matching two border rivals, Maryland and West Virginia. And the Terrapins, who have thumped West Virginia pretty good their last few meetings, are continuing the trend today, taking the lead early and holding a 34-7 advantage. Second down play and a run by Bruce Perry.
And we've talked about how innovative Ralph Friedgen's offense is. You know, he was talking to us the other day about where he thinks about some of those plays. You know, he goes to church some days. When his mind wanders, he actually thinks of plays while he's in church. And they generally work, no matter where he thinks of them.
Said he dreams of them sometimes, and got that from his dad, who used to think up plays, just come to him at a certain time. Scott McBrien still in at quarterback. He's already set a Maryland single-game bowl record for passing yards. He's passed 300, and heading for 400 at this pace. And through the hands of a couple of Mountaineers and incomplete.
So Brian King was the last guy to have a shot at it. and he would have scored had he, unless he was tackled by his old roommate, Scott McBrien, he would have scored on that one.
JoJo Walker had it go through his hands, the Maryland receiver, and then King had a shot at it.
We talked at the very beginning of this game of the balance of the Maryland offense, and now McBrien has thrown for over 300 yards, but they still have run the ball effectively, particularly when they had to.
Heavy illegal motion against the offense. The player was moving toward the line of scrimmage at the snap. That penalty is declined, fourth down.
You know, just this is the second one that's gone through the hands of West Virginia defenders. That one through the hands of Brian King, Adam Jones, Pac-Man Jones missed one earlier, remember?
Mm-hmm.
Oh boy, he knew he was off to the races.
Only the second punt today for Adam Podlish. Pac-Man Jones, the deep man for the Mountaineers, runs up in a hurry, makes the catch. Actually, it's Frazier, not 19. And he's to the 25-yard line. 8-yard return of a 33-yard punt. West Virginia have the ball. We return to Jacksonville with 11:13 left in the game. 34-7 Terrapins. Philadelphia, new expansion team in the AFL. Looking forward to that. So West Virginia takes over. Sorry, Pat.
West Virginia defending champion, Tampa.
Incomplete pass intended for Pennington, broken up by Madu Williams. We haven't been able to see Pat today because this Maryland defense has bottled up West Virginia, but Quincy Wilson, a talented running back. Of course, his dad was an NFL player. His dad, Otis,
great player,
played for the Chicago Bears. And Quincy from Weirton, West Virginia, and he was telling us that he really has a good appreciation for what football means to the people of West Virginia, how they live and die with the Mountaineers' exploits. They travel to see them play, and Quincy had a legendary prep career, 3,200 yards rushing as a senior with a record 47 touchdowns, won a state championship, and he said the people in Weirton talk about that state championship as if it were yesterday, and it was his senior year in high school when he was West Virginia Player of the Year. In his career as a running back,
we have an ineligible receiver downfield. Gets the offense 5-yard penalty in the previous spot. Replay second down.
Quincy rushed for 6,161 yards and 90 touchdowns in his high school career.
He's had a pretty good career here at West Virginia. Yeah. Absolutely. Quality guy, too.
Came in as the fifth leading rusher all time for the Mountaineers. And his dad, Otis, the former NFL linebacker.
Yeah, good one. And that championship 1985 Chicago Bears Super Bowl team. Remember the shuffle and all that kind of stuff? The Fridge and Jim McMahon.
A lot of fun.
Yeah, it's players.
Yep.
Walter Payton. But Quincy Wilson's only been able to carry the ball 10 times today. In their two biggest wins against Virginia Tech, he had 33 carries, and against Pittsburgh, he had 34 carries. But because of the nature of the score of the game, he's just not been able to touch the ball enough. Because, you know, West Virginia could not keep this game close early, they really took one of their biggest weapons, Quincy Wilson, right out of the game.
Marshall blasted out of bounds by Jackson. Jackson's had a homecoming today. He's from Largo, Florida. Nickwell from Seminole High School, Seminole, Florida. Fullback, linebacker, quarterback there, punter, twice All-State.
I'd say he's a pretty good athlete, is that what you're telling me?
As if we didn't know it already from watching him today.
Yeah, had a nice season. You know, you're talking about blocking a kick, intercepting passes. There's a rugby kick again. Effective.
Shooter backs away from it. And to the 27-yard line where it's downed, and Maryland will have the ball again. 48-yard punt. And we invite you to stay tuned because coming up next on NBC, Allstate presents Brian Boitano skating spectacular. Olympic gold medalist Brian Boitano, Christy Yamaguchi, Ilya Kulik. A New Year's extravaganza on ice and a special performance by Brian McKnight, the R&B sensation. That's Allstate Presents. Brian Boitano skating spectacular coming up next on NBC.
Another sport you appreciate, right, Tom?
I do indeed, and I really appreciate especially Brian Boitano and Christy Yamaguchi, who have maintained their standards at near competitive level. None of this just going through the motions, putting on a show as they have gotten older. They obviously can't do some of the things they did when they were in Olympic gold medal form, but they've never compromised their standard. That's what I've always admired about both Brian and Christy.
With a nice run there by number 33, Josh Allen. And just kind of skated through tackles.
Very nice. We could get you on figure skating if you like.
My ankles wouldn't hold up, even as an announcer. It's a beautiful sport, though, I have to admit. Appreciate it from afar.
Hard to believe it was almost 2 years ago now that Sarah Hughes won the gold medal in Salt Lake City. One of the great moments.
What a great performance. Great upsets, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Melendez, the intended receiver on that incompletion from Scott McBrien.
You know, we talked to Scott McBrien the other day, and he's at least with us, he was a serious, nice guy, very serious, thoughtful guy. But you get the feeling that when he gets on the field, he just has a really gregarious personality, in the sense that we saw him bouncing over people, jumping over guys, high-fiving people, running all over the place. Just when he puts the uniform on and the number 7 on.
There's King 11, his best friend, looking at number 7, under center, or behind the shotgun for the Terrapins.
And Wiley Wood, number 6, was Wiley made for a couple years, too. Oh, boy.
Fenner and McBrien now approaching 350 yards passing. He's hit 18 of 29, 2 touchdowns. He rushed for another. He's hit 7 different receivers.
But again, Tom, once again, there's no one near him. I mean, the pass protection, the offensive line has just been terrific. I mean, he's a talented thrower. He's got good receivers. But West Virginia, even though they blitz, they've been unable to get to Scott McBrien, and I think that's the key.
Maryland Bowl record, 351 yards passing for McBrien.
Well, he had 349 earlier in the year against North Carolina. Surpassed that today.
Had 4 TDs and 2 rushing TDs in that one.
Tackle by Ben Lynch, the nose tackle. You know, we were talking to Jeff Castile about Ben Lynch, the nose tackle from West Virginia. Said, you know, he has played well in every one of our games, a real disruptor. That's Ben Lynch. And, you know, his job is to kind of keep people away from linebackers, but he can make plays as well as he did just there.
How many 350-yard passing days you have?
In warm-ups, you count warm-ups too or not?
It can. Just, you want, I mean.
The whole season.
I can't check.
Well, he's going to ruin the single game.
No face masks, leather helmets.
All that sort of thing.
Don't pretend like you don't know. I know you do know.
I can still name all 13 states. Look at that, nice. 351 yards. No interceptions, too. That's a key stat. Turn the ball over.
Only 6 during the regular season, the least in the ACC.
Yep.
Nice ratio of 16-6 in the regular season. There's adding to the total, Melendez. Slides down.
You know, I know they're going to give the MVP to McBrien or Sooner or somebody like that, but you know to whom I would give it? It would be the offensive line.
Right.
I'd give it to the whole offensive line for Maryland. Those guys have just been great. Hayer, number 70, left tackle. He's back next year. C.J. Brooks, he's a junior. First team All-ACC, he's back. Kyle Smith is back as well.
Now, ahead 34-7 here in a rivalry game. Is it time for Coach Friedgen to call off the dogs or call off the Terps?
Well, put some other seniors in or some of your walk-ons that will practice so hard.
That one complete to Walker. Hit by King. And they continue to pitch and catch with 8 minutes left. Ralph contemplating the scoreboard.
Contemplating his 10th win of the season.
After starting 0-2.
Ralph Regan knew that first game was going to be tough. A lot of people didn't think, he talked about it. He knew it was going to be a difficult one. They ended up losing the first 2 games. but his team responded.
Open the season with a loss at Northern Illinois.
Florida State.
Right. That's a common problem in the ACC.
Yeah.
Harrison tried to make a one-handed stab, couldn't quite get it.
Well, you know, there's not too many teams have won 10 wins, had 10 wins over the past three seasons. I mean, that's pretty good company for Ralph.
I'll say.
Yeah, man.
That is an elite group.
You know, you see a lot of teams, do it for a year, you know, sometimes two, but he's got a program going. If you do it for 3 years, that's a program.
Washington State picked up their 10th in their bowl game.
And Bill Dolba, congratulations to them. They had another terrific year.
So close to losing that first game at Notre Dame in overtime.
Yeah.
Josh Allen, tackled by Grant Wiley. Allen a little shaken up. Looks like he's going to limp over to the sideline. He's just a sophomore, remember? Josh Allen, man. And has had some impressive numbers for the Terrapins, and 2 years remaining for him.
Nearly a 1,000-yard season for him, even though he split a lot of time with Bruce Perry.
From Bladensburg, Maryland, Eleanor Roosevelt High School.
Wasn't he the 100-meter champion in high school? Was I right about that, read that?
Yep, state champion, class 4A in 100 meters. And runner-up in football, Eleanor Roosevelt High School, as JoJo Walker walks into the end zone for the touchdown. 14-yard touchdown pass from McBrien to Walker. Third touchdown pass of the day for that young man, Scott McBrien. He ran for another. He's passed for over 350 yards.
Yeah, and now Ralph's saying, we get bringing the other guys. Get the other guys ready.
Yeah!
Novak for the extra point.
Hey, Dick!
It's good.
Hey, Dick! Yeah!
We have seen this one matched two hot teams. West Virginia had won 7 in a row, Maryland 9 of 10, but it has been a very, very impressive showing by the Terrapins today. The latest, the touchdown by JoJo Walker. McBrien, his third touchdown toss. It's 41-7 Terrapins.
Glenn Vickers!
AJ Harris. Harris tripped up at the 10-yard line. Well, Scott McBrien having a great game today, and the Gator Bowl has seen some legendary players. Archie Manning with Ole Miss, 71 Gator Bowl, broken left arm, threw for 180 and 95 running, but Auburn won the game.
What a great player he was. Wow.
Thurman Thomas, a freshman, Oklahoma State, the 84 Gator Bowl, ran for 155 yards, the MVP as they beat South Carolina. In the 96 Gator Bowl, Donovan McNabb, a freshman quarterback for Syracuse, threw for 309 yards and three touchdowns, coupled to Marvin Harrison. And then Michael Vick, a quarterback for Virginia Tech, 2001 Gator Bowl, threw for 205 yards as Tech beat Clemson. And Scott McBrien will have his name up there and on the all-time great Gator Bowl performances, passing for over 350 yards. His backup quarterback is loosening up on the sideline. That's Joel Statham, the redshirt freshman from Chatsworth, Georgia.
So you wouldn't, didn't like my idea about giving it to the offensive line?
Oh, I like it.
It's just not going to happen, right?
His name's going to be in the record books, though. And the backup quarterback for West Virginia is on the field now. Charles Hales, Jr., Ellisville, Mississippi. Played in five games during the regular season.
Yeah, Rich Rodriguez is actually really high on Charles Hale. Says, you know, we don't really consider him a number two quarterback. Played very well. You know, started against Boston College, played well. Rich Rodriguez said we have a lot of confidence in him. Completed, you know, almost 60% of his passes. Very, very accurate thrower. Jason Colson's in at running back as well.
And Travis Garvin, who had been suspended, is on the field for the final time. He's a senior from Bradenton, Florida. Hales with a quarterback draw.
Yeah,
Tackled by Andrew Smith as he picks up a first down on a gain of 13.
You talk about Scott McBride, boy, what a game he had. He had 381 yards to 8 different receivers, as we talked about. Really spread it around.
3 touchdowns passing and 1 running. 21 of 33 for those 381. Garvin knocked down after making the reception.
He had a 92-yard touchdown reception against Virginia Tech early in the year. See that healthy average, 19.2 per catch.
So coach originally suspended him for the game, then reconsidered, reinstated him. Said he would not play in the first half, but perhaps in the second, and he told us that he might get into the seniors at the end of the game, which is exactly what happened. Carried by Jason Colson. He's a redshirt freshman from Rochester, New York, who had 228 yards rushing, played in 8 games during the regular season, scored 3 touchdowns.
Well, as you look at Scott McBride, member Ralph Regan said you need to be tough, you need to have heart, you need to see the field. He's certainly proven that not only today, but the last 2 years at College Park.
And has made an emphatic statement to his old school West Virginia, having beaten them 3 times, and here in the Gator Bowl most decisively with a career-high 380 yards rushing, or 381 yards passing, excuse me.
To me, the amazing thing is how Coach Regan had these guys ready to play from the first snap. They really didn't look like they laid off for 5 weeks. You know, Tom, they came in that first drive, they did everything well. There's our man Kyle Smith. he does have some fun. He's a good guy. Derry, Pennsylvania. For a big night, they go to Latrobe, he said.
Latrobe's their big rival. His dad works in Latrobe, but I'm sure everybody knows that he really is from Derry. They had a big RV that they came down in, decorated in West Virginia colors, that has been parked in downtown Jacksonville for a few days and is been drawing a lot of tailgate action. How can say that?
Big Ed, he calls dad. Big Ed, father of
not Kyle. Squeezing the football. He did it today. He got a couple of offsides against West Virginia, but we told on you.
Sorry about
Kyle.
That, Kyle.
In a world driven by hunger, at a time when the innocent struggle to survive, one force fights for decency, justice, and chicken.
Third Gator Bowl championship. They will have a record of 3 wins, no losses, and 1 tie in Gator Bowl competition, while West Virginia, in its 4th Gator Bowl appearance, will go to 0-4.
And for Ralph Regan, his 31st game as head coach of the Terrapins. In pretty good fashion.
That Gator Bowl record crowd you saw, all-time Gator Bowl record at Alltel Stadium. They had a couple of attendances over 80,000 before the refurbishment. So an all-time record crowd at Alltel Stadium for the Gator Bowl game. And they put in the extra seats. These two programs are well traveled with their fans. Joel Statham, quarterback now for Maryland. The backup, Joel, is a redshirt freshman, Chatworth, Georgia, 6'1", 207. Played in 5 games in the regular season. Passed for 156 yards, no touchdown, and 1 interception. Ralph Friedgen is about to get a shower.
Oh, luckily, the temperature's near 70. Well, Statham really played the second half of the Georgia Tech game when McBride went out with a concussion. And played well. Yeah, here it comes. Here it comes. Oh.
Didn't quite get it up high enough there.
That's
missed altogether.
You know, for a team that won 10 games, that was really a poor effort.
False start, penalty flags down.
Oh, I thought you were calling a false start on the Gatorade.
Well, it was. They were determined.
False start. I guess the offense, losing in the offensive line. Prior to the 5-yard penalty.
There's a tradition. Most coaches, they like to drop. You know, most coaches like to drop that one.
Well, you have a feeling that if that's what it takes, they'll go through it, huh? 10 wins, Yeah. Bowl games, three straight years, program turned around. Maryland will go all time in bowl games now. 8 wins, 10 losses, 2 ties in their history. Had some great coaches over the years at Maryland. Bear Bryant was there starting his career. Jerry Claiborne was one who had great success. Here's Humbert.
White tackle, 6 defense. Maybe Jerry
Claiborne was his trademark defense, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was indeed.
Kind of odd, but effective for him. In fact, maybe it was effective because you didn't see it that often.
Yeah, indeed.
And no question that the Maryland program is on the upswing. And off again. Down to 2 minutes remaining in this Toyota Gator Bowl. Second down and 9. Humber again getting the call, bouncing off tacklers. And short of the first down, fumbled the ball, but Maryland recovered again, I think.
Well, for Rich Rodriguez, getting these guys, you know, turned around for next year. Again, his goal was to kind of keep this program very, very consistent. Again, the two back-to-back years.
And, you know, I was talking about Maryland coaches and Bear Bryant. Jim Tatum, remember? He won a national championship, Maryland's only, I think. And
54.
Tom Nugent. Lou Saban coached there for a year. We mentioned Jerry Claiborne, and we mentioned earlier Bobby Ross. So Ralph Regan.
It's a good company.
Yep. Inside the final minute. This one hasn't been close for a while. Statham. 5-yard line. Alex Lake on the tackle. And let's take a chance to recognize our MVPs. Not much doubt. I know you gave the offensive line some props, but it has to be Scott McBrien for Maryland, passing for 381 yards, and his former roommate, Brian King, the West Virginia MVP, the safety. And they'll embrace here as soon as the final gun sounds. The families will get together, and the outcome of this game will not harm their friendship. But McBrien, 381 yards, hit 64% of his passes, 3 touchdown passes, 1 rushing to 8 different receivers. An impressive performance by Maryland's offense, defense, and special teams, especially Steve Suter, who returned to punt 76 yards for a touchdown. Ralph Friedman, as you said, Pat, had his team ready to play from the outset. And once again, they dominate their border rival, West Virginia, winning this one by a 41-7 count. Yeah, Coach Rodriguez, Coach Friedman there at midfield.
Yeah, we're really impressed, Tom. You know, the offensive line kind of set the tempo, allowed those great athletes they have to really do their thing. And indeed, Scott McBrien responded. Suter was sensational. And then a whole bevy of Terrapin receivers.
And let's go down to Lewis Johnson.
All right, Tom, thanks so much. Ralph Friedman, it's finally over after the beginning. 0-2 and then a long run and then a big game today. Talk about how excited you are about the finish here.
Well, I think we played very well. I mean, this team is one play away from being in the BCS. And Miami had them beaten. Winslow made a great play. I mean, we got to jump up in the charts here. You know, I think we're one of the top 10 in the nation. We haven't been getting the recognition we need. I think we do.
What does this mean to you? Third bowl in 3 years under your tenure, 31 wins. No other ACC coach has done that in history. What does that mean to you?
Well, I have a good staff, and I have a great support, and I got great kids. And we play together, and When you play together, you maximize your potential.
And tell me about your senior quarterback, Scott McBride, and the performance he had this today.
I wish I had another 2 years with the kid. He's really just starting to get the idea of things right now. And I'm so happy for him.
Would you mind parting the mic with him right now? Here he is. Scott, congratulations on an incredible game. What does it mean to you to have a record-setting day, last game at Maryland against an old team in West Virginia?
Oh, it means a lot. I'm just so proud of this team. You know, I'm proud of this coaching staff. I'm proud of this whole football organization. I'm very proud to be a part of it. And what a great way to go out with just a W.
Enjoy the golf in Florida, gentlemen. Congratulations on a January 1st win. All right, Tom.
All right, Lewis. So Scott McBride in his final game has won for the books. And his friend Brian King is there. And they will exchange embraces and perhaps talk about happier times for Brian. And Scott maybe will gloat a little bit. And for Ralph Friedgen and the Terrapins, an impressive 10-win season and perhaps a head start on next year as they beat West Virginia 41-7 in the Toyota Gator Bowl. The Terrapins dominating offensively, defensively, and on special teams to whip the Mountaineers once again. Again, it was 41-7 Maryland over West Virginia. Coming up next on NBC, Allstate presents Brian Boitano's Skating Spectacular. For Pat Hayden and Lewis Johnson, this is Tom Hammond saying so long from the Gator Bowl in Jacksonville, Florida. You're watching NBC. Stay tuned for skating. Happy New Year, everybody.